Bloomington Central Catholic has won 3 state titles and will be the 6th different opponent to try and derail Driscoll's unprecedented drive for a 7th consecutive state title. The Saints and the Highlanders kick it off next.
Welcome to Champaign, Illinois. We're at Memorial Stadium for the Class 4A state title matchup in the IHSA football state championship games. Welcome, everyone. I'm Sarah Kusak, and how about this for a nightcap with our Class 4A games? We have Driscoll Catholic playing Bloomington Central Catholic, both teams 13-0. Both teams were the number one seed in their playoffs. Driscoll eyeing their 7th state title. We'll have to see how this goes. Let's go upstairs to our announcers today. Lee Hall, take it away.
All right, Sarah, thank you very much, and a belated happy Thanksgiving to you and yours. Welcome to IHSA football here on the IHSA TV network. Lee Hall along with Greg Bradshaw. 4A state championship game here tonight, Greg. It's going to be historic one way or another. Driscoll's trying to bring home their 7th straight. Central Catholic trying to become the first team to win a state championship in 4 different classes.
Yeah, we're hoping for a great game. Bloomington Central Catholic will not back down. They have their own tradition. Everybody knows about Driscoll going for their 7th. We're looking for a good ball game, good physical football game tonight.
And here's the road to Champaign. They beat Eureka. Led that game 21-0. Decatur St. Teresa was a 38-7 win for Central Catholic, and the 35-34 win over Mount Carmel was a thriller. Central Catholic scoring with 20 seconds to play. For Driscoll Catholic, they've had a running clock in each of their 4 playoff wins over McNamara, Chillicothe IVC, Chicago Christian, and Coal City in the semifinals last week, 41-14. That's the big question tonight. Can Central Catholic compete with the likes of Driscoll Catholic? And for that, we go to our key players of the game. First for the Saints.
Well, Ryan Waldron is their everything back. He needs to have a big game tonight. You see his stats there, 1,800 yards, 24 touchdowns. They're going to pump him the ball, and he's going to have to make big plays for this team tonight.
He has had a great year defensively for the Saints. We look up front, the big fella, Zach Ayer, who's been playing with a cast on his hand for the last month.
Yeah, he's physical, and he is going to have to play good physical defenses, as is that whole defense to stop Schwabe and company and Franken. He's going to get into the backfield, and hopefully he's going to be able to make some big plays, maybe cause some turnovers.
As you can see, Zach plays both ways, as he is the center for the Saints as well. Now our country insurance key player for Driscoll Catholic, we've seen him before, and he's back again, Tim Franken.
Yeah, you can take your pick on their offense. They got a lot of weapons, but we chose Tim Franken. He's 6 foot, 192 pounds. He's a very physical runner. He does it all. He can catch the ball, and he is really the guy they want to get to establish the running game tonight.
And for defensively, it's Kevin Palermo. Same guy as last year. He was your key player.
Yeah, Kevin is a great player. Two-way player, only one of 3 guys that go both ways. And Kevin, you could see 6'2", 225. He can run, and he's real physical. And he's a great player and a great defense.
It's tradition against tradition here tonight in the 4A state championship game. Let's go to our PA announcer, Jeff Fritzen, for tonight's starting lineups.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, here are the starting lineups for the Class 4A state championship. First, let's meet the defense from Central Catholic, Coach Bobby Mays. Defensive end, number 58, Brendan Gazelle. Defensive end, number 84, Dylan Johnson. Defensive tackle, number 70, Joe Ring. Defensive tackle, number 66, Zach Heyer. Linebacker, number 44, David Murray. Linebacker, number 60, Austin Sherwood. At linebacker, number 32, Ryan Waldron. Strong safety, number 34, Pat McNeil. At cornerback, number 8, Dan Curran. Cornerback, number 11, Blake Rave. And at free safety, number 9, Adam Rebholz. And now here's the starting offense for Addison Driscoll. First, the coach, Mike Burzawa. At tight end, number 45, Kevin Palermo. at left tackle, number 60, Andrew O'Reilly. At left guard, number 59, Vinny Maselli. At center, number 70, Anthony Arena. At right guard, number 72, Michael Labadesa. At right tackle, number 57, Kyle Sanders. Wide receiver, number 11, Austin Baker. Wide receiver, number 1, Travis Christie. Wide receiver, number 25, Joey Calabrese. At running back, number 2, Tim Fraken. And at quarterback, number 9, Dave Schwabe.
All right, there you have our starting lineup. Central Catholic won the toss. They deferred, and so it will be Driscoll Catholic with the ball to start things off here in the 4A state championship game. Six straight state championships for Driscoll Catholic. Has it been close? In the last five, they've won by an average of 30 points. Keys to the game brought to you by Chevrolet. See what's new at ChevyDriveChicago.com.
Well, you just said it, Lee, for Central Catholic, it's survive early. Well, you just mentioned each of the last six times it's been a blowout. Central Catholic needs to get some confidence. Great defensive back play. They're going to throw the ball. Schwabe likes to get rid of the ball quickly. They've got great athletes at the receiver position at Driscoll. They're going to have to make great plays tonight and get Frankham in the secondary. And then lastly, they can't be too conservative. You can't come in here against Driscoll and be afraid. You've got to take some chances and get some big plays. Here's the keys for Driscoll. We talk a lot about their special guys, their specialty people, but really it starts and ends with their offensive line and defensive line. And they're going to be physical up front. If they can do that tonight, they're going to have some success. They love to create turnovers and get big plays and start steamrolling. So they look for those. They like to score off turnovers. And then lastly, make sure their quarterback's protected.
Nick Campanella and Adam Davis back to receive for Driscoll Catholic. Central Catholic wearing all white tonight. They call it a whiteout. They did it one other time earlier this year. The kick is to Davis. He has it across the 20 out to the 25 and taken down at the 26-yard line. These two teams faced each other in the playoffs last year. Central Catholic played Driscoll a tough game before losing 28-12 in Bloomington.
Well, that's some motivation coming off of last year. You don't want a team end your season. You get another opportunity, you're going to be fired up. I'm sure Central Catholic's ready to go tonight.
David Schwabe will open up in the shotgun. Tim Fraken to his right. Two receivers to the near side. First and 10 from the 26 for the sixth time defending champ. Schwabe on the rollout, being pursued. And that pass is incomplete. It was intended for Joey Calabrese, but was out of bounds. Here's the guys up front for Driscoll. O'Reilly, Maselli, Arena, Labadesa, and Sanders. Two returning starters on the offensive line. Schwabe at quarterback. Fraken is the running back. Calabrese, Christie, Baker outside. Palermo at the tight end. That pass incomplete. It'll be second down and 10 for the Highlanders. Central Catholic, we mentioned, went all white against Prairie Central and beat the Hawks and won the first outright Corn Belt Conference championship under Bobby Mays, the head coach of the Saints. Here's the fake handoff. Schwabe, Dylan Johnson had him. Now he's loose out across the 30, the 35, the 40 before he's knocked out of bounds there by McNeil. Here's the Central Catholic defensive line. Dylan Johnson, who had Schwabe in the backfield but couldn't bring him down. Ring and air up front. Linebackers, David Murray, Austin Sherwood, who is replacing Sean Stokes, who went out with a knee injury against St. Teresa. Ryan Waldron, the running back, is also a linebacker. Curran Rave, Rebholz, and McNeil in the defensive backfield for Central Catholic. That pickup results in a first down at the 41. This time it's to Fraken. He tries to pop it outside, gets across the 50, and he steps out of bounds at the 40-yard line.
You're getting a good look here at the Driscoll offense. They like to spread you out. They like to run the ball. Schwabe, you saw in the last play, got a first down, and he's run for almost 700, over 700 yards this year. So they've got a nice running game out of this spread shotgun offense.
Time now for a look at our CarX X's and O's. CarX Auto Service, your neighborhood car care center. There you see pretty close on the Lions up front.
Yep, they're very similar from a physical standpoint.
Franken in motion on first down. Is Schwabe still with it? Gains a couple before he's met by several Central Catholic tacklers.
Here's the scoring for Driscoll this year. You can see they've really picked it up during the playoffs. They went from 37 points a game to 44 in the playoffs, and then their defense even a little stingier in the playoffs. They have played great football continuously in the playoffs over the last seven years.
Brings up second and eight. Franken and Davis in the backfield. Davis goes in motion. Here's the pitch to Franken around the left side. Steps it inside. And there he goes. He's gone. Flag on the play. Will it come back? Franken takes it in from 38 yards out. But the initial thought is the flag goes against Driscoll.
Yep, they're going to bring this back. Big break here. Illegal shift.
It does go against the Highlanders, and that is one area of concern for the Highlanders. They've averaged, through the first eight games, they averaged 100 yards of penalties.
Yeah, they do a lot of different types of formations, a lot of motion, and certainly they can get in some trouble with illegal motion, illegal shift penalties, and we saw it right there.
They had three TDs called back due to penalties last week, and here's another one.
Yep.
Right here in the opening moments of this championship game.
Illegal shift, Black, 5 yards from the previous spot, replace second down.
Rodney Bachman, David Dupree, Carlos Burton, Heath Grote, Joseph Ricks are officials for tonight's 4A state championship game.
Central Catholic.
And the Saints will call timeout with 10:44 to go here in the first quarter. And there is Mike Mays, assistant coach. We'll be right back, no score, right after this. Back at Memorial Stadium, second down and 13 for Driscoll Catholic. Schwabe to throw. Has a man to the near side. It's Christie. And he's just shy of the first down out at the 31-yard line.
David Schwabe's pass complete to the
pickup of 12 on third and 13.
That's what this Driscoll
check
offense.
Check that. That'll be third and one. Now.
Yeah, the Driscoll offense likes to do the quick passing game. They don't do a lot of stuff downfield. They like to throw the ball underneath to the receivers, spread you out. That's a good example there. Get a nice big gain off a three-step drop.
On third and one, it's Franken to the left side. Very close. It'll depend on the spot. And we will have a measurement. Jim Franken, the six-foot senior.
It looks like the mark is going to give it to him by the nose. Yep.
Just by the nose of the football.
Nose of the football. Driscoll's going with all backs. They have tackle over, and then they put their man in motion. They have all of their blockers to the left side except for a tackle and guard on the right. And it's just student body left on that play, and they've done it a couple times. That was what was the touchdown play that was called back was in that formation.
This will be the ninth play of the drive right here. First down and 10 from the 30. And off to Frank. It steps it up inside. Still on his feet at the 15, where he's brought down just inside the 15 by Blake Rave after a pickup of 16.
Good look at the quickness of Franken right there. And if it wasn't for the tackle of Rave, he's gone.
Tim Franken, over 1,600 yards, averaging over nine and a half yards per carry.
You can see him there. He's a good physical kid. He's big, about 6 foot, 190 pounds, and runs very, very hard.
First and 10 from the 15. Man in motion is Cooper. And nowhere to go for Franken as the Saints sniff that one out.
McNeil in on the stop.
Yeah, they got a little smarter there. They went all backs to the right. You'll see it here in the replay. All backs to the right. Run the man in motion. Here comes Franken to the right. Look at all the white shirts right there. They finally read that play. It's the fourth time they've gone all backs, and now Central Catholics caught on.
I think they call that snow blind when you got all that white blowing right in your face, don't you?
Must be.
Oof. Second and 15 now. Play action. Schwabe looking. Nobody there. Hare had a hand on him but couldn't bring him down. McNeil chases. Johnson brings him down at the 7. Make that the 6-yard line. Schwabe picks up 14. He's about a yard short of the first down.
He got a block from Tim Franken, and the whole sideline erupted. You will see Schwabe using his ability here. Everyone thinks, you think he's down right here. Look at, and right in the hands of Air, but he gets out. Watch Franken block right here. Boom! And that frees him down within 1 yard.
And you could hear the oohs and ahs from the crowd.
Yeah, you'll get a good look at watch. Well, you're gonna put, watch this.
Screen.
Right here. Ooh!
And there's the other ooh.
Yeah. They're watching the replay here in the stadium, and that hurt everybody.
Well, and that's where Zach Air having a hand in a cast hurts.
Yeah,
he's trying to tackle.
Exactly right.
He's trying to tackle Schwabe one-handed. Schwabe 766 yards rushing on the season coming into tonight. And Driscoll Catholic will call timeout on 3rd and 1 from the 6.
Yeah, the play clock was about to run out, and Schwabe wisely calls timeout. Big play here on 3rd and 1, and talk it over with Coach Buzella. A couple times now, you know, the elusiveness and the strength of Schwabe has turned the sack, a loss, into a game. And that's made some big plays here in the first drive.
Here's a look at that playoff history that we talked about earlier.
Yeah, these two teams are well known in Illinois football. You can see just the great tradition that each has. Consecutive appearances, obviously Driscoll 9 and Central Catholic in 4. And then both of them have played 5 teams that were in the playoffs this year. And phenomenal playoff records from both of these teams. Whenever you have double the amount of wins or more, you know you're playing good playoff football.
There you go. Look at Mike Berzala in the huddle. He was a pretty fair running back himself back in the day. He was running back on the 91 undefeated state champs, the first state championship for Driscoll Catholic. He had a record 4 touchdowns in that championship game against Robinson. G. Nudo was the coach back then. Ozawa came back as an assistant to Tim Rackey, and they revived the tradition for the Highlanders. 3rd and 1 from the 6. Flag, the Saints are pointing that Driscoll jumped. Let's see what, and that is the initial indication. False start on Driscoll.
Driscoll came out of the timeout, hustled up to the line of scrimmage like they were trying to catch Central Catholic off guard, and in that little bit of confusion, they jump off sides, going to cost them 5.
Dead ball, false start, Black. Still 3rd down.
It'll be 3rd down and 6 now instead of 3rd and 1, and that's something that Tim Berzawa and his staff have worked on. He's going to take a look at Bobby Mays there in the center, head coach of the Central Catholic Saints of Bloomington. 8:53 to go, first quarter, no score, 3rd and 6. For the Highlanders. Baker's the man in motion. Schwabe back to throw, flag on the play. Yep. Schwabe runs left.
It's coming back.
And he's brought down, taken out of bounds, and a flag on the play there. And that's gonna hurt. That's probably incidental face mask, I'm guessing.
Yeah, the motion man turned up the field too soon for illegal motion, but now it looks like we may have offsetting penalties with that last flag right along the sideline. Get the call here. Mr. Bachman.
Illegal motion, Black. Incidental face mask, White. Replay the down. 3rd down.
Back on the East Bluff in Peoria, we call that a do-over.
That's right. That's right. Let's do it again. Let's do it again.
Well, that's a tough break for the Saints because they had a second straight penalty against Driscoll Catholic and that incidental face mask on the tackle.
when really they could have just let him run into the end zone, but of course they don't know that.
Yeah, right.
Third and six again. This time it's Christie in motion. Schwabe back to throw. Franken, another flag. Two more flags. Franken's knocked out at the two.
Coach Brazile is going nuts on the sidelines. He's putting his hands up there like, what could we do? Another penalty. I don't know if he's mad at his own kids or if he's yelling at the refs, but he's definitely frustrated. Right? Well, look at hand on the hips. Look at him there. He's frustrated.
They have taken all kinds of steps. One of the players is a Big Ten replay official. They brought him out to work with the team and try and get these penalties straightened out because it's been a sore spot for the Highlanders.
Yeah, it looks like both penalties were against Driscoll, and we're going to march him back. Yeah, certainly they're killing themselves right now. That's the second time they've had a first down here, right down here in the inside the 15, and now they're going backwards. This one's going to be real costly because the hold was about the 20-yard line.
They spot the ball at the 30.
Little block in the back against Black. Decline. Holding, spot foul accepted. 10 yards from the spot.
It's like multiple choice in school.
Yeah, this is a big play right here because if for some reason they would get it, it would really deflate Central Catholic. Huge play.
Third and 25. Schwabe barking out orders. Christine Calabrese to the near side. He looks for Baker instead. Baker in the end zone. Incomplete. Javier Safford was there on the coverage for the Saints. And it'll bring up fourth and 25. And guess what? There's a flag on the play.
Here's the replay on the play. You see Schwabe going back. And Schwabe's going, thrown up for Austin Baker, a 6'6 wide receiver. And just a nice job there by Safford knocking
it
away.
Disregard the flag.
Do you remember last year's championship game? We had about three or four of those in the first half.
Yeah.
Where they
waved
threw
it off.
A flag and said, no thanks.
Yeah, well, I think right now Central Catholic's got to be excited about this stop. It's a big stop to start the game, give their defense some confidence. A lot of confusion. You can see on the side a lot of confusion right now on the Driscoll sideline.
Palermo is back to punt. Try and aim for the corner. And it's touched there by Driscoll, and it'll be Central Catholic ball on their own five. 8:31 to go here in the first. Driscoll Catholic and Central Catholic scoreless.
Best clientele.
Central Catholic from their own five, and Ryan Waldron, the senior, will get back to the line of scrimmage and no more that time. Here's a look at the offensive line for Central Catholic. Ring, Yelton, Ayer, Wambacher, and Levitsky up front. Reb Holtz, the quarterback, he's a junior. McNeil at fullback, Waldron, Safford, Curran, and Johnson. For Bobby Mays and the Bloomington Central Catholic Saints.
A lot of familiar names there because we said most of them on defense. They have nine guys
Nine guys play both ways. Only three for Central Catholic, and that could be a key to this ball game. McNeil, the first back through, out to about the nine. Pickup of about four.
Here's a look at the defense for Driscoll. We got Stenzel, Liberto, and Campanella up front. And they're 3-5. Here's some of their linebackers, Adam Davis, Blaskovitz, and Palermo. We talked about him before, and Bacall in the backfield, Joey Calabrese, the quarterback going both ways, David Schwabe, and then Ricky DeVito on the outside.
Third and six for the Saints. Pitches to Waldron. He gets outside to the 15, first down, and he's out at the 21-yard line.
Nice execution, big play here. Big play there. You just take a look at the offensive lines. Actually, that's Tuscola and Galena. That was a good game a little bit earlier today. But that was
Galena
good execution.
Galena won despite having a smaller line.
That's right. But you got a good look at Waldron there and his first carry and a big carry to get them out of the hole there with their backs to the wall there.
1,828 yards for the senior coming into tonight's game. First and 10 for the Saints. Here's Waldron again. Slips a tackler, and he's out to the 30 and will be very close to another first down for the Saints.
There we go. Now we're looking to the offensive lines there. You see Central Catholic, 6'2", 239. Driscoll, 6'3", 218. Again, not that big of a difference. They're kind of mirror teams on the offensive and defensive lines. Not that much difference between the two clubs.
6:52 to play in the first. That was McNeil, the lone setback, trying to go for the first down here on second and one, and it looks like he got a favorable spot. Look at the scoring for Central Catholic. Regular season, they picked it up a bit in the playoffs, giving up a few more points. That game last week really skewed their defensive average, giving up 34 to Mount Carmel.
Yeah, the big stats 4-0. You know, to get here. That's right. What really counts. And then you throw all the stats out now. You got a one-game season. And a good start, really, for Central Catholic. We talked about them surviving early, a good stop, and now a couple first downs.
First and 10 from the 32, Rebholz to Safford. He steps back and gets to about the 37-yard line. Pickup of 5 for Javier Safford, a 6'1 senior. 42 receptions, 631 yards receiving so far this season for Safford. There you get a look at Coach Brzala. And there's Adam Rebholz, the junior quarterback for Central Catholic. His first game of the year as a senior, as a varsity quarterback, 3 for 12, just 32 yards and 4 interceptions against Eureka Roanoke Benson. He came back and he's had a great season since then. And up to the 40-yard line that time is Pat McNeil. Bring up third and about 2 for the Saints.
Yeah, McNeil doesn't get a lot of carries, but it's important just to establish him inside so they can get Waldron open on the outside. So not bad just to keep pounding that in the middle. Open that up for Waldron now. Big play here on 3rd and 2.
McNeil again the lone setback. Waldron split out wide as a receiver. Rebholz, nowhere to go. Reverses his field, tries to get something out of nothing, and he'll be stuck right there at the 38, loss of a couple. Didn't quite have the speed to get outside there and get the first down.
It looked like he had the room, but then he decided to stop. I think he would have been better off just trying to use a little bit more speed to the outside, but unfortunately got caught up, and now they're going to have to pass. Good stop by Driscoll there.
So defense, the tail so far, and penalties for Driscoll Catholic, keeping this game scoreless as we pass the midway point of the first quarter. Javier Safford to punt for Central Catholic. And it's Joey Calabrese standing at his own 30-yard line for Driscoll. Safford averages almost 35 yards per punt. That one will bow, takes a Central Catholic bounce and then some down to the 20-yard line. It's a punt of 41 for Javier Safford. And the Highlanders will take over at their own 20. Tale of Two Cities, Bloomington, just about 45 minutes up the road from Champaign, 64,000 McLean County. You see Driscoll from Addison and DuPage County. Enrollments fairly similar. Central Catholic in the Corn Belt Conference and Driscoll in the Suburban Catholic Conference. Let's go downstairs to Sarah Kustak.
Thanks, Lee. A little something for you about these two teams. Now, they're playing in the Class 4A game. Well, Bloomington Central Catholic has won 3 football championships in Class 1A, 2A, and 3A. Most recent in 94. And let's get to this play, and I'll fill you in on Driscoll.
All right, it's 1st and 10 for the Highlanders. Schwabe standing at his own 15. Fakes the handoff to Frank and takes it himself, and he's out to about the 30-yard line. Let's go back to Sarah.
Thanks, Lee. And Driscoll, we know, has been talking a lot about how they're going on their 7th consecutive state title game if they were to win today. But they also have a state record, 33 straight playoff games. In the last 8 seasons, they've compiled a record of 101 wins, only 8 losses.
All right, Sarah, thanks a lot. They've won 27 straight overall, dating back to week 5 of last year. 34 straight playoff wins. Schwabe to the far side. Baker 6'6 receiver for Driscoll takes a knee, caught it on the knee, so it will be down there.
Schwabe's done a nice job here to start the game, and unfortunately the penalties have hurt them, but he's carried the ball four times for 40 yards. His running has been effective. There you just see the three-step drop again and getting the five-yard gain, enough to get the first down, but this is their style of offense.
The senior Schwabe only took one snap as a quarterback before this season. That was in third grade, and he's had a great year. Another quarterback draw, bounces it outside. McNeil tries to drag him down, and he steps out of bounds at the 46-yard line, and that is a gain of 19, and that's the thing that Coach Brzawa will talk about Schwabe. He gives you that he can run or throw look, and they haven't really had that.
Yeah, he's a real weapon when he carries a football. Really, I think this is part of their game plan. We've seen him carry the ball more than Franken so far, and he's a nice job here fouling his running backs and the offensive lineman pulling. That does a nice job in the open field.
59 yards already for the quarterback of Driscoll Catholic on the ground. First and 10 from the 46. Hand off to Franken inside. Waldron got him by the ankle and brings him down at the 42 after a pickup of four.
Nice play there by Ryan Waldron, their third leading tackler on the season. Plays both ways, and it's going to be called upon to really do duties on both sides of the ball.
Second and six. Three receivers to the near side for Driscoll. Schwabe to Christie. He catches it at the 39. His momentum almost carried him out of bounds. Instead, Ryan Waldron will do that for him at the 39-yard line. Pretty good pop there on the sideline. But it's a first down for the Highlanders.
Yeah, they're just taking what they get. And right now, they're just not playing really in the flat. And they're able to get 10, 12 yards by just throwing the quick 5-yard out right there to Travis Christie. So they're just being patient now and taking what Central Catholic gives them. Right now they're giving them the flat.
First and 10 from the 34. Here's Frank. Fumble! And I believe it's Central Catholic ball.
Yes, it is. Central Catholic, great play there. Schwabe carried it, and just a nice play. We'll see who makes the play right here. Here's the play, fakes to Franken, and Schwabe keeps it behind the pulling flanker. Right there, who was it? Number 58. Who's that? We got 58, nice play.
There's no 58 on the roster.
Well, we're gonna find out. We gotta find out who he is. He made a great play there, punched the ball. Looks like he's the one who recovers it as well. Number 58.
Catholic's secret weapon. That's comes right. Up with a big play with 3:30 to play here in the first. Schwabe back to throw. Safford's wide open. Safford at the 30, the 20, the 15, the 10, the 5. Touchdown. Looked like he might have stepped out of bounds at the 3. He used their official as a moving screen.
He did.
And rode it all the way into the end zone for the touchdown.
Wide open down the middle of the field. Broken coverage really by Driscoll. And just a great job after catching the ball.
70-yard touchdown catch.
Here's the replay. Here's the ball going up in the air. Just a great throw right in stride. He catches it. And now you'll see him use the official.
Yeah.
The official gets right in the way here. Kind of gets shielded right here. We think he stepped. Oh, no, I don't think he stepped out. I think he goes all the way in. Great play, big play.
Michael Finger for the point after. It's up and it's good. And it's 7-0 Central Catholic on a 70-yard touchdown pass from Adam Rebholz to the senior Javier Safford, his ninth touchdown catch of the year.
You know, big play, and that's what we talked about, not being conservative. One of the keys to the game, we said, was take some chances. There it was on first down off the turnover. That often happens, Lee. After you get a big turnover, you take a shot. That's what they did, and pays off 7-0. Just a great start, both offensively and defensively here for Central Catholic.
Saints fans on their feet. Defending 7A state champion St. Rita wins the Chicago Prep Bowl today, 31-7 over Morgan Park.
Saw St. Rita down here last year.
Yes, we did. The alma mater of our boss. It's not? Oh.
He just jumps on the bandwagon.
He's a bandwagon St. Rita guy, yeah.
That's
okay.
Right. Well, good start to this game, and you know, now we're going to see Driscoll come back out, and I'm sure they're excited and ready to get their offense back on the field.
I'm not sure they've trailed this year.
Yeah, maybe first time.
Fenger with the kick, bounces at the 15. Davis picks it up, takes it across the 25, 30, 35, and brought down at the 40. Where Driscoll will take over a return of 25 yards. Let's take another look at the Central Catholic touchdown.
Here it is again. We're going to look closely here if he steps out of bounds. Great camera work here. Looks like this step right here was where he may have stepped out.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, there is no instant replay in high school. And,
very close.
That was very, very close. I don't know if it was, it might have been inconclusive as it was, but the referee was busy shielding the Driscoll defender. And, yeah, here we go again. Another penalty against Driscoll.
That'll be their fourth penalty, and that's not counting the one that was offsetting.
Yeah. Rhythm is always a big part of football, and really Driscoll hasn't had a chance to get really in rhythm yet with this game, and Central Catholic's been able to take advantage of that.
So Driscoll trails 7-0, first down and 10 from their own 20. Schwabe rolls left. McNeil make that Murray in pursuit. And driven out of bounds by Ryan Waldron at the 23. The Driscoll fans want a late hit, but they were right there on the sideline. And we got to find out who number 58 is for Central Catholic. He's not on the roster, and he was right in the middle of this one again.
Yep. Here's a replay here. We had five wide receivers, no backs, no protectors for Schwabe. Nobody open. Good job in the defensive backfield. And Waldron gives him a little bitty shove at the end, and wasn't much.
Brendan Gazelle is 56. I don't know if he changed numbers or not. Schwabe rolls to the right side this time. Here comes the pursuit. And he's run out of bounds and throws incomplete. Good pursuit by the Central Catholic defense.
Yeah, not only good pursuit, but good defensive back coverage. We said again, that was a key to this game, good defensive back play. And Schwabe's looking to throw the ball downfield. He's got a curl down about 15 yards in and out. They both are covered. And here they see the pursuit just stringing out the play. Schwabe just decides to throw the ball away.
Brings up third and seven. 2:56 to go here in the first. Central Catholic out in front on a 70-yard touchdown strike from Adam Repholz to Javier Safford. Three receivers to the near side this time for the Highlanders. Schwabe's pass knocked down again by number 58, whoever he is. Let's listen. It is Gazelle. He's 56 in the program.
Yeah. Here's a great play right here. He comes out. He sees it's going to be a quick screen out here. Nice job getting, knocking the football down. Big play forcing the Highlanders to punt. A lot of emotion right now for Central Catholic. A lot of momentum.
Palermo on his own 9-yard line to punt. Safford catches it at his 41. Now reverses field. He's coming to far side.
He's got some blockers.
Inside. He's got some blockers. Waits for more blockers. Johnson with a block. And then he's tackled out of bounds at the 32-yard line. Return of punt of 36, return of 26. Javier Safford is having quite a ball game here in this first quarter.
Well, he sets this up so well. He went to the right, and then they had a wall set back up to his left. So he does a great job drawing the defense in, and now you can see he gets behind the wall. Does a nice job setting up his blockers here. Gets a few extra yards. Nice 26-yard return. Ball inside Driscoll territory at the 32-yard line.
First and 10 for the Saints. Here comes the reverse. Safford has a blocker. Tries to razzle-dazzle that time and will lose a couple. Nothing doing that time for Javier Safford, whose brother plays basketball at the University of Missouri. Justin Safford.
They were waiting for Safford there. Anthony Campanella stayed home. Number three did a great job from his defensive end position. You'll see it on this replay. Here comes the reverse. Nice pitch, Safford. And you'll see Campanella just be very, very patient out there, making sure that he doesn't get outside. Good defensive play by the defensive end staying home.
Driscoll defense allowing just 12 points a game this season. Second and 12 from the 34. Repholz back to throw. Has a man at the 25 and brought down there. It's Javier Safford again, taken down by Adam Davis.
Nice throw by Repholz. Safford just sits out there at 12 yards. You'll see it here in the replay. Here's the drop back. Nice five-step drop, good feet. Steps up in the pocket. Safford catches the ball. Little hesitation by Safford. Cost him, I think, 2 or 3 yards. You really want to duck. You'll see it right here from this angle. Catch the ball, go get the first down. He kind of hesitates. Nice pursuit there by the defense. Bringing up third and two.
Repholz is 3 for 3, all of them to Javier Safford, who has 85 yards receiving already in this ball game. Here's Waldron. Gets down to the 20.
First down.
The Saints move the chains with 1:45 to play first quarter.
Just a simple counter tray on that. They pulled the backside tackle and guard. And Waldron gets the first down. Just a good play calling so far by Central Catholic, keeping Driscoll off balance, a little bit of run, a little bit of pass, not always Waldron.
Oh, Safford.
Boy. Pretty obvious.
Yeah, I mean, wide receiver doesn't need to do that. That's the first penalty against Central Catholic. Just forgot the snap count, apparently.
Driscoll was bringing
Mid ball, false start, White. Still first down.
And here's a look at the officials. We introduced them to you earlier. Carlos Burton, Heath Grote, Joseph Ricks, Rodney Bachman, the referee, and David Dupree. First and 15. Pitch to Waldron as Repholz was being taken down. He pitched it, and Waldron falls on it at the 36. So a couple of miscues in a row for the Saints here on a good drive up to this point.
You'll see right there is the blitz on the play by number five, Mike Belaskovitz, and he causes the fumble. Nice timing by the blitz on that play.
Yeah, Belaskovitz, 6'2", 145. Mike Brzezowa says he's undersized, but you can't measure his heart, and he showed a lot of heart there. Second and 26, Repholz back to throw. Almost picked off. At any rate, Davis got a hand on it. Safford was the intended receiver. He had Neal in the flat, but tried to force it in there to Safford instead.
Yeah, this is his first really poor decision. He could have just dumped it off there in the flat to Neal, but he goes down the field, and just a nice effort there and a good defensive play there by Adam Davis.
Third and 26 for the Saints. They were driving. A penalty and a fumble recovery has pushed them back to the 36-yard line.
Just don't want to make a big mistake here.
Repholz looking deep again. That one's going to get picked off. Schwabe is opposite number of the quarterback. Who's going to tackle him? Flag on the play. Air tackles him at the 35. Another flag back at the 12-yard line. Repholz just threw that one up, and
yeah,
there were
did.
All kinds of black shirts back
yep.
there.
Not a bad play if it's fourth down, because it's almost like a punt, but still had another down. You don't have to get it all back in one play. Talking it over there.
The flag was thrown way over on the near side of the field, and the play was onto the far side. I'm not sure if
Could've
it had
holding.
Much of an impact on the play.
Yeah, I was going to say, okay, that's like where holding would be. That's holding on Driscoll. Another big break.
That'll be after the interception, so it'll still be Driscoll ball.
I think that's the holding, though, on the receiver. No, maybe
oh.
not. Maybe not. It's not defensive.
Well, we'll see. Let's let them figure it out.
Yeah, I know. too much guessing here. Let's see. It looks like it's going to be
Driscoll. Little block in the back. Black. Spot foul, first down.
Here's a replay. You see Rebholz looking downfield. He doesn't really have anybody. He just decides to throw it deep with the guy in his face. And there's a nice job by Schwabe. It ends up working all right for Central Catholic. It's almost like a great punt to the 5-yard line.
Yeah, it ended up that way after the penalty.
Yep.
Schwabe in the shadow of his own goal line. Quarterback draw. They've had a lot of luck with this. Busts it outside. He might go 40 to 50. Good block from Calabrese. Schwabe still on his feet, and he's going to go all the way. 94 yards for David Schwabe. This time, no flags, and the Highlanders can tie it with the extra point.
Well, he's been using his feet, and you saw him last play use his hands on the interception. He's been really the story for Driscoll so far. Here's the replay. He just gets through. They spread everybody out. Five wide receivers to the sideline. Takes the quarterback draw. Here you can see Calabrese, his personal protector, on the way down. And he does the rest. Great run, 94 yards.
Brett Warren on for the extra point. It's up and good. And that ties the game. That 90-yard rush is a 4A title game record, breaking the previous record of Scott Kinsella of Joliet Catholic. 1978 had an 81-yard rush. That one, 94 yards by the Driscoll Catholic quarterback. Take another look.
Here it is. I just pull. Nice pulling trap right there. Got the guys out front blocking the linebackers. A good cut to the outside. Now it's off to the races. Now he's got Calabrese coming down here with a block. And he's just got a good speed and walks into the end zone. Good execution. Nice play. Tie ball game.
It's his 11th touchdown rushing of the year. His previous best was 47 yards.
Yeah, 8 carries for 160 yards so far for David Schwabe. We're still in the first quarter.
Yeah.
Pretty good quarter.
The Saints defense is going to have to account for him.
Yeah, we said kind of early, I said it looked like that might be part of their game plan, was not to use Franken so much, but to really feature Schwabe as their running threat, and it's really paid off for them early.
Nick Stenzel takes care of the kickoff duties. Warren is the place kicker. This is Dan Curran at his own 10-yard line. He brings it out to the 25, where the Saints will take over. Pick up a 15 on the return. Just 4 seconds left in the first quarter, and we are even. And I think just about anybody going into a state championship game against Driscoll Catholic would take that after 12 minutes.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Central Catholic, they gave up the big play, but they've had a good first quarter. We talked about surviving early. They've done that. They want to get into a football game, a four-quarter game with Driscoll, and see what can happen, and it's been a good start.
This should be the final play of the first quarter. Waldron picks his way through the middle up to the 30-yard line. Pickup of about 5. And it'll bring up second down and 5 when we return. We played 12 minutes. Central Catholic of Bloomington. Driscoll Catholic tied at 7 after one quarter play here in the 4A state championship game. Be right back. Back at Memorial Stadium in Champaign, Central Catholic of Bloomington and Driscoll Catholic tied at 7. After 12 minutes as we get ready to start the second quarter, it's second down and 5 for the Saints from their own 30-yard line. We get a look at Kevin Palermo, the linebacker for Driscoll Catholic, as they show blitz. And Rebholz barely gets the handoff to McNeil. Highlanders were right there in the backfield. They timed that beautifully. And it'll be a loss of a couple for the Saints.
Yeah, Palermo came right up the inside gap here. He was coming on a blitz and wasn't accounted for, and comes through and makes a big hit. Luckily, the ball wasn't fumbled there, but a nice play by Kevin Palermo.
Yeah,
there.
Rebholz said, hey, wait a minute, let me get my hand out of there.
Yeah, right. It's a good look at him right there. Good football player. Has been playing for Driscoll the last 3 years, and just the key to that defense.
Rebholz back to throw, looking for Safford again. It's a jump ball. And Calabrese was there on the coverage for Driscoll Catholic. Offensively, after one quarter, 110 yards total offense for Central Catholic, 220 for Driscoll, and we're tied.
Yeah, most of that came on that 90-yard run or 94-yard run from Schwabe. But, Rebholz got to be a little careful. He's getting maybe a little bit greedy. He's thrown some balls into some traffic. Really was lucky that didn't get picked off because Calabrese was right there for that play.
Saints will have to punt on 4th and 7. Safford is zone 15. Calabrese waiting at his 45-yard line. Bobbled. Almost got in there for a block. And almost fumbled. It is fumbled. Calabrese fumbled it. Waiting for an indication. Central Catholic thinks they have it. They do. A big play there. Joey Calabrese fumbled the punt return. And the Saints recover at the Highlander 43-yard line.
Here's a play right here. Here's the kick, a little bobbled snap, but he gets it off. And Calabrese tries to run over and catch it. Just kind of stuck between his legs. A nice hit there by Dan Curran, and he makes the hit and makes the fumble recovery. Huge play for Central Catholic.
Here's the pitch to Waldron. He's brought down just about at the line of scrimmage that time by Davis.
Nice play by Adam Davis. He's trying to get the fans fired up.
Second on the team in tackles. Adam Davis is coming to the University of Illinois to be a catcher.
Yeah, well, he's making some stops out there. That was a nice hit from a great offensive outside linebacker.
Second and 10 for the Saints. Driscoll showing blitz. Somebody moved. I think Central Catholic might have moved on that one. Here's a look at our first quarter stats. Penalty is against the Saints. Menards, first quarter stats, save big money at Menards.
Well, you can see there you've got Driscoll really lopsided in rushing yards, primarily because of the long run by Schwabe. And Central Catholic, surprisingly, nice job by Rebholz early, had the big pass.
Dead ball, false start, White. Still second down.
And then that second to last line there, those penalties really hurt Driscoll in the first quarter, 5 for 45, but took away some really big plays.
Waldron split out his wide receiver this time. Rebholz over the blitz. Here comes McNeil, and he's brought down at the 44-yard line. Pick up a 4. Bring up 3rd and 11.
They tried the little screen here. Let the lineman come in, and you'll see just drop it over the line of scrimmage. Have it out front, but a nice play again coming in there from the side. Driscoll really got some good pursuit to the ball right there. Great play by number 3, Anthony Campanella.
3rd and 11 for the Saints. They went out front 7-0. It's 7-7 now. We're just under the 10-minute mark here in the second quarter. Safford is the man in motion. Rebholz to Dylan Johnson. He's brought down at the original line of scrimmage. There's a flag on the play, and I believe Safford might have turned upfield before the ball was snapped for Central Catholic.
Short gain. It's only 2 or 3 yard game. Looks like Driscoll will probably decline this, and it'll be 4th down and a decision time.
And now a flag dropped on the near sideline, right in front of the Central Catholic bench.
Sideline warning.
Illegal motion, White decline. We also have a sideline warning against White.
It will bring up 4th down and 11, and the Saints will have to punt again. Unable to capitalize on that Driscoll Catholic fumble. Fourth and nine from the 42.
Yeah, pretty good field position game right now going on here. Wise decision here to punt the ball and make Driscoll go the length of the field.
Safford aims for the near sideline. Takes a Central Catholic bounce. It's still inbound. My goodness.
Wow.
He'll be downed at the two. Oh, my.
That ball was aimed for the sidelines, and it just took a left turn.
Looked like it was going out at the 20, and he read the break. It's a punt of 41 yards for Javier Safford, and the Highlanders will take over when we return. 9:04 to go in the second. Game tied at 7. Lee Hall, Greg Bragshaw back at Memorial Stadium. Central Catholic and Driscoll tied 7 all. We've seen Dave Schwabe run for 160 yards out of the quarterback position. He never played quarterback before this season. They gave him the starting quarterback job on the first day of two-a-days, and he has done an outstanding job. I mean, can you imagine as a quarterback yourself?
Yeah, it shows a lot of confidence in his athletic ability. And he's just gotten better and better every week, and you can just see he's a great athlete. He can throw the ball well, and certainly he's shown that he can do some damage with his legs.
1 yard line. Gives to Franken, and he's out across the 5 to about the 6, where his forward progress is stopped. They started their last drive on the 6 yard line, and they start this one on the 1.
They just want to get some positive yards here with their back against the goal line. You see nice job there by the offensive line executing the trap and pick up good 5 yards and give them a little breathing room. Nice job up front by the Driscoll offensive line. Nice trap block there by number 57, Kyle Sanders.
Second and 5 for Driscoll. And they will take timeout.
Second time the play clock has run down. They're getting the plays in a little bit slowly and just causing them to have to call a timeout there.
Let's go downstairs to Sarah Kustak.
I am with some special Bloomington Central Catholic people. Mother, brother, sister of head coach Bobby Mays. And not only is Bobby on the sideline, but also Mike and Steve here with Doug, starting QB of the 82 state championship team. But first of all, Joan, can you tell me a little bit about your boys and your daughter and how proud you are of all of them?
Well, we're very, very proud and very happy for them. It's wonderful when you love something as much as they do that you have some success doing it. It means a lot to them, and we're just here to support them, and an awful lot of friends in Bloomington Normal that are here too.
And Doug, you got a chance to play here at Bloomington Central Catholic and be the starting QB for that state championship team. What was it like, and what is it like coming back and being on the sideline with your brothers?
That was pretty neat. It was a long time ago, but we kind of started a tradition back then, and now it's kind of expected for our squads to get, you know, in the playoffs and do well, and it's just great to be a part of it after 25 years to see that it's tradition continues.
Now, we were lucky enough to have Steve Mays be an analyst earlier today, and I said he sent me some notes about each of the brothers, and he sent a note on Pam and said that Pam is by far the toughest and the best athlete of the family. And Pat, I just want to hear what you have to say in this great family of athletes.
I'd say I'm probably the best cheerleader. I've been watching him play ball since Bobby was 10. So I did play a few sports in high school, but I'm really their biggest fan.
Last question, back to Doug. How do all three of your brothers get along on the sidelines?
It can get kind of tense. Bobby and Mike especially. I think Steve's kind of the mitigator between the two and kind of keeps them separated. But they get along real well and they think alike, and I think that's why they have a lot of success.
Well, I know you guys want to get back to watching the game, so thanks for the time.
Thank
and good
much.
Luck for the rest of the day. Lee, back up to you guys.
All right, thanks a lot, Sarah. First and 10, Schwabe back to throw. And brought down from behind by Joe Ring. Joe Ring with 93 tackles on the year coming into this ball game. And he dropped Schwabe at the 10.
Big play by Joe Ring here. Driscoll's thinking they can get out of here, out of this the shadow of their own end zone. He just doesn't give up. Schwabe's been hard to bring down, but he does just enough to get him down. I'm trying to do just enough to get the words out here.
Tell me about it.
That's right.
Somebody told me earlier I sound like Bill Cartwright.
I know.
Former Chicago
Bulls. Or Bill
Bowl.
Jackson, either one of them.
Yeah. Second and 15. Schwabe looking for Christie. He's got him, and he's got a first down. It'll be very close. He does have a first down. He steps out at the 25-yard line. You know, Bobby Mays was quarterback for Central Catholic back in the mid-70s, their head coach. Each of his brothers followed Mike, Steve, and then Doug, who led them to the 82 state championship.
Yeah, it's a lot of football in that family, and it's just continued to go on and on. With them all coaching on the sidelines, it's a great, great thing to do. My family's the same way. My father coached for so many years, and now my kids are playing, and it's great to be around high school football in Illinois.
It's a Driscoll first down from their own 25. Rankin's in motion this time. The handoff is to Palermo. The tight end getting a look out of the backfield. He's got a first down after a gain of 11. Kevin Palermo.
It's another look that Driscoll gives you, putting the big guy in the backfield. He's showing some of his strength, running like a bull. And just a little bit of different look. You got Franken with his speed, and now you got Palermo with his power. And a really good run there, good hard-nosed run from Kevin.
I guess he is listed as a running back, but he looks like a tight end to me. Another first down for Driscoll. Davis in motion. Handoff is to Franken. He's to the 40. And gets into the Central Catholic backfield, defensive backfield. He is near midfield at about the 48.
Here's the pulling trap, and Franken just behind him making some good moves inside. You can see his quickness in contrast to Palermo's power. And Franken's had a great year. Again, 1,600 yards on the year and all those touchdowns. And just going to be a good college football player. Looking at some good schools, Holy Cross and Georgetown.
Second and three, here's Schwabe. Keeps it himself. He's out across midfield for another first down. David Schwabe had one rush for 24 yards in last year's state championship game, and he is running all over the place here tonight. There is a flag.
Yeah, there's another good look at Schwabe, and a nice gain, and it's going to be, not sure here what the call is on the field.
Dead ball, personal foul, green.
Or black. Didn't see that.
That's the sixth penalty of the game against Mike Brzozowski's squad. 40-1 in his third year as head coach of the Highlanders. And that's good. You see the guys policing themselves right there. Grab a face mask, have a talk with your buddy. A look at Bobby Mays patrolling the sideline. I always give him a hard time about that old hat, and I won't do it anymore because he says the reason he wears the old hat is his brother gave it to him right after his dad died. He's got his dad's initials on it. R.A.M. Bob Mays, Big Bob. He died 2 years ago. He says that hat's going to get retired after the season. We'll continue after this play. Schwabe complete to the 40-yard line to Calabrese. And I'll bring up third down. Says he wears those hats till they fall apart. I had a newer hat, but it just didn't look, I just don't look good in a new hat. It doesn't feel good. It's like a good pair of shoes. So a lot of sentimental value for the hat worn by Bobby Mays. And on the helmets and the hats of the coaches, you'll see a sticker that says Big Bob, and that's in memory of his father. Would be delighted to be here again. 5:05 left, second quarter. Franken has some room to run out across the 50. Rave couldn't bring him down. Curran can't bring him down. He steps back inside, and it's a touchdown for Tim Franken, 60 yards. Tim Franken, his 29th touchdown of the season.
Here's a give to Franken. It's designed to the left. He cuts it back to the right. When he gets out in the open, he's dangerous. You can see his great stride. He makes a good cut right here, and he's gone. When he gets in the open field, not many people can catch him. Nice run, big run for Driscoll. Give him a little momentum here, middle part of the second quarter.
Now Bresky will attempt the extra point this time. That's Phil Albreski, a sophomore. And it's 14-7, Driscoll with the lead. Now 4:51 to go in the second quarter of our 4A state championship game. Back in Champaign, Driscoll with a 14-7 lead. And here's another look at the running styles of Tim Franken.
Very simply, when he gets out in the open, as we said, he's very, very tough to stop. He's got a great stride and very strong.
He just looks like a football player, too. Javier Safford will watch that one as it goes out of bounds. And that will be another penalty on Driscoll. That'll be their seventh penalty, and Central Catholic can make them kick over, or they can take it on their own 35, whichever they prefer. See what Bobby Mays wants to do.
Here come the big boys. Looks like they're going to take the ball at the 35. Well, it's a big part of the game right here for Central Catholic. Driscoll's starting to get a little momentum, and if you've watched Driscoll football, they like to get steam rolling once they get going. So this is a big drive. Central Catholic needs to take care of the football.
The legal procedure. Black declined. Ball will be placed on the 35, first and 10.
Somebody gave him the heads up on the colors.
That's right. He's cluing in a little bit.
First and 10 for the Saints. They trail now 14-7. Here's Waldron. He gets about three. Palermo in on the stop. Frank Barkall in there too, number 44. 5'11 junior.
Yeah, Coach Mays right here just doesn't want to have a big mistake. We don't want to turn the ball over if you're a Central Catholic, and just get a first down, get two first downs, then get an opportunity, maybe get a score before half. Just do not want to have a turnover here.
Islanders showing blitz. Here it comes.
There's a loose turnover ball right there. That's exactly what happened.
Driscoll ball. Saints turn it over, and that's the kind of mistake you can't afford against Driscoll Catholic.
It looks like it just the ball just he hits it. Yeah, he gets hit right there with Waldron. Waldron is just coming in for the fake, and they brush up against one another. And Repholz isn't expecting it, and there comes the ball out. And just a lot of guys right there ready to get it.
It'll be Driscoll ball just inside the Central Catholic 30-yard line. You talked about them not wanting to have a mistake, and there it was.
Yeah, this is the kind of thing that really Driscoll feeds off of. Look here for a big play, because they just love to get that momentum and feed off of it.
Three receivers to the far side. Instead, it's a draw to Franken. Dylan Johnson brings him down from behind at about the 24-yard line. Pick up a five. It'll bring up second and five.
Little delayed draw back to Franken. He's got the hot hand after that last run, and he gets a nice 5-yard gain.
Driscoll has not been in many close games this year. Cooper in motion to the far side. Schwabe fakes the handoff, takes it himself. He's got some room. Here comes McNeil. And he's forced out of bounds at the 16-yard line, where it'll be first and 10, Driscoll.
Here's the fake to Franken, and then here comes Schwabe bouncing it out to the outside. Does a nice job coming down here, breaking a tackle, get a good 10-yard gain, and another first down for Driscoll.
11 carries, 169 yards for Dave Schwabe. First and 10 from the 16, the Saints defense needs to stiffen here. They don't want to go down by two scores before halftime. Here's Schwabe down inside the 10, still on his feet, very close to another first down as Brendan Gazelle is there to bring him down.
Here goes Schwabe again, and Brendan Gazelle actually gets on his back and goes for a ride. Schwabe just carries him here for about 4 yards. Shows a little strength from David Schwabe. Again, he's really carrying the load today with his legs.
Spot it just inside the 8. It'll be second and a short 2 for the Highlanders with 2:35 remaining in the second. Schwabe rolls out to his left, looking for Palermo. Pretty good coverage, tries to force it in at the last second, and it's incomplete. Bring up third down. Nice coverage that time by the Saints.
Yeah, here comes Schwabe on the rollout. He wants to get Palermo coming across the field. Looks like he's going to run and then tries to drill it in at the last second, actually right in the hands of Palermo, but a good job there by the defense getting their hand in there and knocking it away.
Third and a short 2. Franken the lone setback. Schwabe this time from under center. Gives to Franken. Looks for somewhere to go. Nowhere to go. Gazelle is there. But he stays on his feet. He stays on his feet and he scores. Tim Franken, what a run from 8 yards. Looked like he was dead to rights behind the line of scrimmage. Stays on his feet and scores. And it's 20-7 Driscoll.
Great individual effort by Tim Franken. You see his strength there. He was stopped. That was going to be a big play. Probably would cause Driscoll to have to kick the field goal, but they got great individual athletes here, and Tim Franken just showed why he's one of the best running backs and an all-stater in 4A.
Phil Albreski, the sophomore, will try for the extra point. Brett Warren kicked the first extra point. Now it's Albreski, who I believe is a younger brother. I believe his older brother is Nick Albreski, who kicked on some of the earlier state championship teams for Driscoll. They take a 21-7 lead here with 2:17 to play. Take another look. What a great individual effort.
Yeah, here you'll get to see just Franken. Here he comes on the pitch. He doesn't see anything, and now you've got 1, 2, 3, 4 white shirts all around him. Just keeps moving. Guys keep blocking, and he finds a way to get into the end zone. Great individual effort there by Tim Franken for his second touchdown of the game.
6 foot, 192-pound senior. He's a load and tough to bring down. Mike Brzezowa says he has tremendous vision. He's balanced and has God-given speed, and he showed a little bit of all that on that play. 21-7 with 2:17 to play in the half.
Those kickers love those pumpkin balls. You see that ball right there? That ball's been kicked a few times there. I like this because it's a straight-on kick. You don't see many of these with the wooden toe right here. This doesn't happen very often anymore. Right there, there you go. The big kick.
And out with high-button shoes.
Yeah.
Curran brings it out to the 29-yard line for Central Catholic, where they will take over and try and get something going here before the half.
Well, as good as the first quarter was for Central Catholic, really the second quarter's been a different story. As Driscoll has shown just why they've been dominating in Class 4A. They've been having some big plays, really behind the legs of both Schwabe and Franken.
Here's the handoff to Waldron. He's got room to run to the 40, out to the 50. Watch the strip from behind. And he has a first down pickup of 25 for the senior Ryan Waldron.
Good explosion there by Walden. He gets through so quickly. He hits the holes fast, runs full speed, runs through the tackle there of Calabrese. Nice cut and big play. If Central Catholic gets some points here, really give him a lift before they go into halftime.
Feed it to Walden again. He's brought down at the line of scrimmage by Adam Davis, rather. Adam Davis, number 27, almost didn't play for Driscoll this year. He had a thumb injury, wasn't going to come out, joined the team after the black and gold scrimmage, got his 10 practices in, had to sit out 3 games, played one half, then injured his ankle. They thought initially it was a broken tibia. Second opinion, it was a sprain. He came back 3 to 4 weeks later and was huge for the Highlanders
in week 8 and 9. And a nice job there defensively by Steve Schwabe for the Highlanders. He's a junior.
Here's a replay right here. Nice job. Good effort here by Rebel. He kind of steps up in the pocket, just tries to float the ball up over the top, and Schwabe makes a great play. And knocking it away, otherwise it would have been a nice 20-yard gain. And they would get down in close to even field goal range. But instead it's third down and 9 for Central Catholic.
Minute 13 to play, first half. McNeil is the lone setback. Waldron split out to the top side of your screen. Here's Safford, high for the catch. It'll be short of a first down by a couple of yards.
Nice catch by Safford here. He just runs a little bit short of the first down marker, but he goes up nice. Nice grab. But good defense right there to keep him from getting the first down. Nice throw and catch, though, to set up fourth and short.
Driscoll calls timeout with a minute 2 to go here in the second quarter. They lead at 21-7, 4th and 3 for the Saints. Here's a look at our championship action tomorrow here on the IHSA TV network. Metamora undefeated, taking on Morris in the 5A title game, followed by Joliet Catholic and Lamont in 7A. It's Wheaton-Warrenville South against Lake Zurich, and then Naperville North against Glenbar North for the 8A title. Here on the IHSA TV network, we hope you can join us then.
There'll be some good football tomorrow. Some great stories there. Of course, Glenbar North, everybody knows, with 4 losses, 5-4 coming in and getting all the way to the state championship. What a great run for them. And they want more, I know. The way they've been playing, they're ready for that rematch.
Saints will go for it on 4th and 2. Catch by Safford at the 31-yard line. The clock will continue to run, and now they'll stop it to move the chains. Joey Calabrese there on the coverage. First down, Saints. 5th catch of the game for Javier Safford. Central Catholic will now take a timeout. They've got one remaining. 56 seconds to go here in the second quarter.
It's a nice drive here from Central Catholic. Safford's done a nice job. That was a good big play there on 4th and short. Just good execution, not doing too much, just getting what you need, moving the chains. Give yourself a chance now with 54 seconds to go.
We talked about Schwabe, who had never played quarterback before this year. Javier Safford, who now has 5 catches for 99 yards and a touchdown for Central Catholic, number 5 in white, didn't play as a freshman. This is only his 3rd year of football.
Yeah, he's been really a big weapon for them today. He's made some big plays on that punt return, set them up, had the big catch, touchdown earlier in the first quarter, and did a nice job on this drive.
317-43, the rushing yards advantage for Driscoll over Central Catholic. Saints with 3 receivers split to the top side of your screen. Rebholz in trouble, gets out of trouble. Still on his feet inside the 30 and down to the 21-yard line. Very close to a first down with 43 seconds and counting.
Great scramble here by Rebholz. Nothing doing on the pass route. Just keeps moving his feet and gets a 9-yard gain. Really nice run there.
2nd and 1. 29 seconds left. Rebholz steps up in the pocket. Has a man. That's Ben Heaton. And he's down to the 5-yard line. And Bobby Mays will call his final timeout after the pickup of 17. And boy, this is reminiscent of the finish of the game for Central Catholic against Mount Carmel last week.
Just a nice job there again, avoiding the rush and getting the ball out to Henton for that big play down to the 5. No more timeouts now for Central Catholic, so they'll get a couple of shots into the end zone at minimum. They're going to probably have a field goal attempt here. Just a nice drive, important. You know, they get the ball to start the second half, and you know, this would be really, really a positive for them going in the locker room to fight back, because you know, a lot of times when you're playing Driscoll, we've seen it in years past, teams get in this situation and they just start
fold. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. And Central Catholic's done a nice job here.
We saw this Central Catholic team last week against Mount Carmel give up a go-ahead touchdown with under 2 minutes to play in regulation. They blocked the extra point, came down and scored with 20 seconds left on the clock. There's 20 seconds left on the clock right now. And this is a big gut check for Central Catholic, who survived one and really stepped up to one last week, as you see Bobby Mays. 16 years, 114 career wins at Central Catholic. Both teams out of timeouts. First and goal from the five. Rebholz quick throw, Safford. Touchdown, Central Catholic. Javier Safford having the game of his life and the biggest game of his life. And the extra point would get Central Catholic within a touchdown.
Great play there. Really good coverage, too. Really good coverage. Yeah. Just simple one-step drop right here. Just fire the ball. Good coverage, but yet good strong hands from Safford. Takes the big hit, but holds on for 6 points. Six catches for 104 yards, two touchdowns for Safford in the first half.
The point after by Michael Finger is good, and it's 21-14, Driscoll Catholic with 16 seconds to play in the half. Big drive, big gut check for Central Catholic, and they come through.
Yeah, it was Ryan Weldon really got that started with that big 35-yard run really to start. I don't know, they weren't thinking maybe getting 6 points, maybe just thinking of just not making a mistake and going in 21-7, but he got that big run, started them to down the field, and really good execution from then on in. Rebholz did a nice job in that drive too, as he made some great scrambles and good throws and got him in position to score.
8 plays, 71 yards, and just 201 for the Saints. And that was huge, huge, because we've seen Driscoll the last five, they've won six straight. We've seen them in their last five state championship games win by an average of 30 points.
Yeah. Well, it's just a lot of times they wear people down, and that's something that they're going to hope to do here because, you know, we talked about it earlier, Central Catholic has 9 guys going both ways, but this gives you extra energy. You stay in the game, you make big plays, it gives you the energy you need to keep playing hard, and it's nice now they know they can drive. If they need to come back with a 2-minute drive at the end of the football game, they know they can do it because they've done it once already.
Davis and Campanella, Nick Campanella back for Driscoll. Campanella picks it up at his own 16-yard line. Goes to the far side, he's brought down at the 29 with 10 seconds to play in the first half. 13 yards on the return for Nick Campanella. Nick is a sophomore. Guessing he's the brother of Anthony Campanella.
I would think so, or cousin. Got some cousins probably in the Driscoll program.
Schwabe will take a knee, and that's how the first half will end. So Central Catholic went up 7-0. Driscoll scored 21 unanswered, and the Saints answer to go into the locker room down 7, and they've got to feel pretty good about that.
Yeah, it was a good football half for both teams, actually. Driscoll had to overcome some penalties, but really good football.
Sarah Kustak is with Mike Brzawa. All right, well, Mike Brzawa will not be heard from. 21-14, his team has been heard from. They lead it by 7 as they go for their 7th straight state title here in the 4A championship game. Back right after this.
There.
From Tolono, Scott Hamilton. And guys, this has been a long first half. I mean, it feels like a game has been played already. And here in this first two quarters.
The first quarter, 50 minutes alone. That's a long high school football quarter. So much has went on. That the ebb and flow of this game has been amazing. Driscoll back to Bloomington Central Catholic. Driscoll for quite a bit in the second quarter, and then Bloomington at the end.
come out and start the second half.
How about two names that have just popped up all over the place for Driscoll? You've got Dave Schwabe, the quarterback, and Tim Franken, the running back. Those two guys have put on a show tonight.
Franken's an amazing athlete. The run that he had for the touchdown was highlight film material, no matter whose highlight film you're talking about. And the best athlete on the field, the best athlete we've seen all day, number nine from Driscoll. It's like it's Tim Tebow from Florida. It's they're running what looks like the single wing out there, getting the ball to him, spreading everyone out, and just letting him be an athlete. And he is
about Juice Williams from Illinois.
In the company we're in, we'll take it. Exactly. I like that even better.
Let's take a look at those first half stats brought to us by Menards. Save big money at Menards. Look at those rushing numbers for Driscoll. 316 yards. Of course, we'll see highlights a little bit. 94 of those coming on a Dave Schwabe touchdown run. Another 60 on a Tim Franken touchdown run. But that's heavy-duty numbers. 362 total yards in the first half.
Yeah, looks like a 94-yard run and a 60-yard run from scrimmage in the first half by Driscoll. So pretty impressive numbers.
The 9-for-13 passing from Bloomington Central Catholic for 127 yards, I think, has been very good.
You know, we take a look on the other side. We always like to look at third down conversions, but, you know, you take a look at these two teams, it seems like they've been having so many big plays. Again, though, Driscoll, 2 out of 4 in their third downs. Penalties have really hurt the Highlanders, though, here in the first half.
Yeah, I think the penalties, you know, really have kind of played a part on both teams. Late first quarter, BCC has a drive, 1st and 10 from the 20, and kind of shoots himself in the foot and doesn't get any points out of it.
A lot more coming up here at the half for a game. Do the Highlanders win number 7 in a row? Bloomington Central Catholic has something to say about that. It's a 7-pointer at halftime. We'll be back after this. Ten state championships combined with these two clubs here in our 4A championship ball game, and right now it's the Driscoll Highlanders by a touchdown. We welcome you back to our IHSA TV network studios as we take a look at our Sports Authority scoring summary here in the first half. Sports Authority dedicated to the dedicated. Big plays. Look at these numbers up here. Javier Safford, a 70-yard touchdown pass from Adam Rebholz, the 3:18 mark of the first quarter for a 7-0 lead. And then after a Dave Schwabe interception and then a subsequent penalty put the ball at the 6-yard line, Schwabe said, you know what, I'm just going to take the distance. One play after that interception, he goes 94 yards, ties this game at 7. Into the second quarter we go. Then Tim Franken danced his way, culminating a 99-yard drive. He goes 60 yards, make it a 14-7 Driscoll lead. Franken again with 2:17 to play in the first half from 8 yards out. Makes it 21-7, 14-point difference, but then a huge big drive here at the end of this first half. Just 16 seconds remaining when Javier Safford caught his second touchdown pass of the night. This one at 5 yards from Adam Rebholz, and we've got ourselves a 21-14 game here at the half. And, you know, you take a look, and we've got Javier Safford having a great ball game. Adam Rebholz doing a nice, solid job for a junior quarterback. This game right now has been about big plays by key players all that we knew coming into this game were going to be key.
Yeah, I've been very impressed with Javier Safford. He's made some huge plays. The touchdown catch at the end of half was in some big-time traffic, and he hung on, took a big hit. And, you know, the junior quarterback, Rebholz, has really done a good job of getting the ball spread around and finding the open receivers. So, you know, I think BCC needs to come out and make a statement early on that they're going to make a good drive and get some points.
You know, every year we come down here, of course, we see Driscoll playing in a state championship ballgame. But every year they're just a little bit different. What do you see different about the Highlanders this year?
Well, I think they're definitely getting their quarterback involved in the run game considerably more than what they have in the past. The last 3 years has been Phil Petey. His job has been to manage the football game, throw the hitch route, make sure that the athletes on the field take care of what Driscoll does best. This year they're putting the ball in the hands of the quarterback and saying, go get us a state championship.
On the other side, Bloomington Central Catholic, I mean, their experience being here, 3 state championships, none in recent vintage, but the thing that impressed me early on, and of course Driscoll helped them out a little bit with the penalties and some of the miscues, a couple of fumbles and stuff, the Saints have played with an awful lot of confidence, I think, here tonight.
Yeah, they have. They've thrown some big passes. Ryan Waldron's made a few big runs in some critical situations, and you know what, give them some credit. They've been able to come up with some turnovers and make some big plays when they've had to get themselves in the game. And you know, I think most people in this crowd here would have said 21-7 going late. Driscoll's got 2 touchdowns in a row. Probably over with, and not going to happen. BCC stands in there and says, you know, we're not done yet.
Quick question. Does momentum matter going into the locker room? I mean, 16 seconds worth of momentum, because that's basically what Bloomington Central Catholic has.
Well, I don't know how much it matters. I know this. It makes you feel a lot better and gives them a good feeling going in rather than going in 21-7 and not being able to get points again at the end of the half. They did get some points, and you know, I think they have to feel like they can compete now.
And they will receive the kickoff to start the second half.
I believe so.
I'm counting on you on that one. Let's take a break. We come back. We've got a whole lot more. This is the 4A state championship game, man. 32 teams started it. Only two are left in Driscoll. Our fourth state championship game of the day, and it's a good one. Glad you've stuck around with us. 24 hours of football here over 2 days on a Friday and Saturday, and we wrap it up here on a Friday evening. Welcome back, everybody. Dave Bernhardt, Jason Kirby, and Scott Hamilton with you. Let's take a look at our Honda halftime highlights. Honda featuring the all-new 268-horsepower Accord V6. Gonna get started, Bloomington Central Catholic. Javier Safford, watch him use the referee right here. Slow down, get your block, there you go. 70-yard touchdown pass from Adam Rebholz to Safford. It's 7-0, Bloomington Central Catholic. Rebholz looking right at you here, zeroing in, and he's gonna go deep, and who's he gonna find? The wrong guy, number 9, Dave Schwabe. Schwabe at the interception, he took this out to about the 20-yard line. Penalty brought it back to the 6-yard line as the Highlanders had to start deep in their own territory. But you know what? That really didn't bother them much, because on the very next play, here's Schwabe up the middle on a quarterback draw, turns it to the outside. Watch this. He will get a block and then just pull away, setting a Class 4A state record with a 94-yard touchdown run, and that ignited the Highlanders, tying this game 7-7. That came in with 10 seconds to play in the first half. Then it was Tim Franken's turn with 4:51 to play in the second quarter. 60 yards, he'll head to the sideline, coming right back at you, a nice little cut. Zigzags his way through for a 14-7 lead for the Driscoll Highlanders. Franken wasn't done. A little over 2 minutes later, from the 8-yard line, he'll get the pitch. Watch this. How many people touch him? How many people does he make miss? And he eventually goes in untouched from 8 yards out. 21-7 the score. Looked like Driscoll is in big control. But then late in the half, Bloomington Central Catholic coming right back. Safford catching his second touchdown pass of the night. It's a 5-yarder from Adam Rebholz. And that's where we sit, 21-14, as we get set for third quarter play. You know, Jason, it was funny because we've talked here about the possible 7 state championships in a row for Driscoll. They've won 6 in a row. They also won one earlier. Bloomington Central Catholic with 3 titles to their credit. This is tradition that you don't teach, you just experience, and it keeps coming back.
Yeah, I think that I've been really impressed with the way Bloomington Central Catholic, with their tradition, has not been intimidated at all by Driscoll. They have decided, we're going to come out, we're coming after you, and I think they've got some momentum going in the second half.
Yeah, I think so too, and it'd be a nice fitting way for Central Catholic. It'd be a 1A title, a 2A title, a 3A title, and looking for a 4A title tonight. I don't know that anybody's won them in 4 different classes.
Greg Bradshaw mentioned just before we came to our halftime break that in the last 5 state championship games, Driscoll has averaged a winning margin of 30 points. And now you start thinking here in a 1-touchdown game. Once again, you're impressed with my numbers I toss out at you, right?
Right.
Very good. Now you start thinking, though, and all of a sudden, do you feel the pressure? If you're a Driscoll player, do you feel the pressure like you can't let down those previous 6?
I don't think they feel any pressure. I think they look so loose on the sideline. Bloomington Central Catholic scores a touchdown, gets a big play. Driscoll gets stopped. Their kids, it doesn't faze them. They seem so confident. Here we come. We're Driscoll. We're going to be here till the end.
I think it's what BCC had to do. I think they had to hang in there and just hope that things press just a little bit. And, you know, we'll see. They've done their part in the first half.
That's for sure. 21-14 is your halftime lead. We'll get set for the third quarter. Bloomington Central Catholic or the Driscoll Highlanders. Somebody's taking home that 4A trophy in a couple of hours.
And we are back at Memorial Stadium. 21-14, our halftime score, Driscoll over Central Catholic. Let's go downstairs to Sarah Kustak.
Scott, as a coach, it seemed as though Driscoll was starting to grab the momentum of that game, and then you come in with that score. How important was that for the attitude of your team going into the half?
That was huge, definitely, no doubt, because they had got the momentum. Our kids seemed a little down on that. We missed a couple tackles there. They had the momentum, and we fought back. Now we're back in the game. We just got to make something happen.
And what have you done to slow down this Driscoll offensive attack?
I don't know yet. We haven't quite figured that out. We've got to get more play up front. We got to quit working upfield so darn far, and hopefully we can. We got to slow down that quarterback because he's just giving us fits.
Sounds good, Coach. Good luck the second half.
Thank you.
Back up to you guys.
All right, Sarah. Thanks a lot, Bobby Mays, 48 years old, superintendent of parks in Bloomington, and someone on the internet accused him earlier in the playoffs of being a white collar guy.
Well, that hat sure doesn't make it look like that.
Bobby Mays, what you see is what you get. He's right. He's done a great job at his alma mater, keeping that Central Catholic tradition alive. 2A champs in 82, 1A champs in 87, 3A champs under Bobby Mays in 94. John McIntyre, the coach for those first two championships. Only Central Catholic and New Lenox Providence have titles in three different classes. Central Catholic trying to become the first team to win a state championship in four different classes. Let's take a look again at our keys to the game brought to you by Chevrolet. See what's new at ChevyDriveChicago.com.
Well, we talked about this early, survive early, and that's exactly what they did. They actually not only survived early, they thrived early. They got the first touchdown of the game, got some confidence, then they withstood the Driscoll onslaught, get that score before half. Great DB play. Haven't had great DB play. They've had some big plays where Franken and DeSchwavi have broken out. We said take some chances. We saw that with the big touchdown pass early in the game to Safford. And again, second half, they're going to need some make some big plays. Driscoll, we said, dominate the line of scrimmage, and they've done that primarily, really, with the over 300 yards rushing in the first half. They've created a couple turnovers, but really what's hurt them, the penalties. The penalties have hurt them, and then protect Schwabe. They've done a nice job. He doesn't need much protection.
Doesn't need it.
Even when they get to him, he's been able to shake them today. He's got 177 yards rushing in the first half alone, and thrown for 46, and just been a good football game, really, and it's kind of fun here as we get ready to go. I just get my popcorn popped if I'm at home, get nestled up, stay nice and warm. You're inside. We're out here a little cold, but it's going to be a great second half.
It's a thrill to be here as we start the third quarter. Nick Stenzel will kick off for Driscoll. Sends it deep. This is Dan Curran. He caught the game-winning touchdown against Mount Carmel last week in the semis with 20 seconds left. He cuts it inside. He's to the 40 and brought down there by Stenzel, the kicker, at the 40-yard line. A return of 32.
Nice cut and a great field position to start the second half, just exactly what they'd like to do.
Take another look at Dan Curran, the 5'9", 140-pound junior.
He's made a big play earlier when he got the fumble from the Calabrese fumble off the punt. Here he makes a great play on special teams again with a nice return. And they're in business on the 41-yard line.
First and 10 Saints from the 41. Rebholz, quick step and drop to Safford. I don't like that. He takes two steps back to try and make something happen rather than just going forward and getting an extra yard or
two. You're not going to be able to do too much of that against this Driscoll team. You need to just get – it's just like playing college football. You catch the ball, you move forward, get the extra yards, and really cost himself two or three there. What a good call to start the second half. Again, they've kind of kept the Driscoll defense a little off balance, mixing up pass and run. Nice play calling by one of the Mazes. I don't know who's calling it.
I think that might be Coach Parker on the offense. I'm not sure. Waldron up the middle again. They had success with that earlier in the ball game, and he's across midfield and into Driscoll territory at the 44. A pickup of 12 and a first down.
Here's the counter tray. You'll see the backside tackle and end coming through. They picked up the blitz, and then he springs through into the second level. Nice job by the offensive line. They brought two inside backers on the play, and they just folded those backers down, kicked out. And Waldron got up in the middle for a nice, nice gain.
Looked like the same play where he gained 25 in the second quarter.
Yeah, it is. That's that counter trick.
Here's the pitch to Waldron to the near side. He's got a block, bounces off his own blocker, and he's brought out of bounds at the 30, inside the 33. That's a pickup of 11 and another first down.
getting yards in bunches so far. We saw that play a little earlier when they had a seven-man front. Here it is, just that toss after the fake to the dive. Nice bounces off his own player. Actually, I think it kind of threw off. Who was that out there? I don't know which one. That's Calabrese or who was that?
No, it was Ben Heaton that he bounced off of.
Yeah, it was kind of just threw off the defense there and got an extra 8 or 9 yards.
First and 10 from the 33, McNeil. The fullback was the only guy in the backfield. He gets down to about the 30. Bobby Mays talking about Ryan Waldron says you have to bring it if you're going to bring him down. As we see McNeil this time.
Here's the play here, just a quick opener. Nice job getting off blocks there. Nice play by there, number 17. That's Trace Jenkins, another one of the brother tandems. His older brother was a great player here a couple years ago.
Second and 7, it's McNeil again. They try to play a little straight ahead football here. That'll make it third and about, they say 7 on the scoreboard.
Yeah, this is four down territory.
Yeah,
this is four down territory right here, so they got two downs to pick up 5 yards.
Takes the handoff. Complete to Johnson at the 19-yard line. It's a Saints first down. Dylan Johnson with the catch.
Nice sliding catch by Dylan Johnson. Here they fake the little counter tray. He steps up, throws it in there, and a nice scoop right there going down to go get it. Here's another look at it from a different angle. Coming back from the backside tight end position. That's that little waggle pass that so many people run, and a nice execution there.
Second catch of the game for the 6'2 junior, Dylan Johnson. First and 10, Waldron up the gut. That's a couple. Saints offense, they're no slouches against St. Teresa. They scored 3 touchdowns in 25 seconds. Waldron, a 91-yard touchdown run. St. Teresa, the Bulldogs muffed a kickoff. Reb Holtz hit McNeil for a 25-yard score. The Bulldogs fumbled the next kickoff. Reb Holtz hit Safford for 29 yards, made it 28-0. It went from 7-0 to 28-0 in 25 seconds. Second and 9. McNeil in motion and flags everywhere. He's probably coming back. Dylan Johnson in for the touchdown. We'll see what the flags are.
Yeah,
McNeil got a head start, it looks
like.
Yeah,
he did. And everybody kind of just stopped and the play kept going.
He'd been all right if he'd turn and run parallel to the line of scrimmage, but he kept going right at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, you got to keep playing, you know, because if you stop and you get a sack or whatever, they could decline the penalty there. So you got to keep playing.
So this is the second time this has happened to Central Catholic tonight.
Illegal motion, White. Repeat second down.
We saw Safford jump early, and this is McNeil. He just forgot the snap count, I think.
Yeah, he just got a little head start. Everybody kind of stopped, and you got to keep playing unless the whistle blows.
Second and 14. Here's the – no, it's Rebholz keeping it himself and takes it down to the 15. Pickup of 8.
Rebholz showing a little bit of his own mobility here. The kind of answer to Schwabe. Does a nice job. Look at that move right there on Franken, and falls forward for another 3 or 4 yards, bringing up 3rd and 6 now, 3rd and 7, and our really biggest play of the second half right here.
Over 1,600 yards now passing on the season for Adam Rebholz in his junior year. 3rd and 6, Saints trailing 21-14. Flag on the play. Rebholz steps up. He's short of the first down. We'll see what the flag is on the far sideline.
Looks like Dan Curran left a little early from his wideout position. It's going to be against Central Catholic. You have legal motion.
Are they just not hearing the count, or are they forgetting the snap count? What do you think that is?
That one was just a tad too soon. It wasn't like he was on the wrong count. He just left a little bit early. Maybe he's anticipating the count.
We saw penalties hurt Driscoll early. Now it's hurting Central Catholic.
A little motion, White. Repeat third down.
Well, Michael Fenger, the kicker for Bloomington Central Catholics, has a 49-yard field goal this year, and he's made 12 of 20, so they do have a field goal kicking game. Just don't want to make a mistake here.
Another whistle.
Yeah, a little confusion. Looks like they call timeout here. Weren't sure on the formation.
Timeout charge to White.
Bobby Mays has his headset off, and his hat's crooked. He's not happy. 7:52 to go in the third, 21-14 Driscoll. And there's our Walgreens Do the Right Thing photo shot of the night. Where do you get hats like that?
I don't know. I don't know if I care to know.
Our thanks to Walgreens for promoting sportsmanship along with the IHSA. 7:52 to go in the third. Driscoll up 21-14. Big third and 11 play here for the Saints, trying to drive for the tie. Rebholz, here comes a man from the, oh, what great sense by Rebholz to avoid the man coming on his backside, but he throws it incomplete behind Dan Curran. It'll bring up fourth down.
Yeah, nice job to elude the rush. He actually had a lot of real estate out in front of him if he would have chose to run.
Watch him sense this guy
coming
on his backside.
Yeah, he steps up here. Yeah. Here, he keeps his eyes downfield, tries to make a big play, but he had some running room. Unfortunately, the ball falls incomplete for Central Catholic. Now we're going to bring up a 37-yard field goal here.
Michael Fenger out of the hold of Adam Rebholz, the quarterback. Greg mentioned he has a 49-yarder earlier this year. From 37, it's long enough, and it's good. Michael Fenger, the senior, with the 37-yard field goal, and we've got a four-point ball game with 7:41 to go in the third. It's a nice weapon to have in the postseason.
Sure it is, and you know, it's just positive for Central Catholic to come out of the locker room, put a nice drive together, and get some points on the board. You know, this Driscoll defense, you know, has been really tough all year, and Central Catholic's been moving the ball, and got to really be pleased with getting 3 points there coming out of halftime.
So Central Catholic will kick it away now, trailing by four.
Really, I think the key to this game, though, is not going to be, I mean, Central Catholic offense has proven they can move the ball. The key is going to be, can
they stop Driscoll?
Can they stop them? Because there's just so many weapons. We saw that in the first half, and, you know, they were lucky to only give up 21 points with all those yards, over 400 yards of offense in the first half alone by Driscoll. So we'll see what the defense can do.
Adam Davis and Nick Campanella back to receive the kick from Michael Fenger. And it's Davis at his own 10. Davis out across the 30. McNeil there for the tackle. Boy, if you play Central Catholic, not only does McNeil play both ways, offense, defense, he's out there on the special teams as well.
Yeah, and that's pretty tough duty when Adam Davis has a full head of steam, 210 yards, and he's running. He doesn't look too inviting to go tackle that guy, but they just stuck their head in there. Nice hit. And I guess that's why you're on the kickoff team, the kamikaze team, you call them.
We talk about how dominant Driscoll has been in the state championship games. You look at this season, they had close calls in week 8 against Marion Catholic. They won 21-7 as they take over here first down and 10 from their own 31. Here's the handoff. Davis comes across. He's still on his feet. They didn't tackle him. You can't just assume he's down. He gets a first down as he makes it all the way out to the 49-yard line. Pickup of 12. Let's go downstairs to Sarah.
Thanks, Lee. Well, Driscoll playing for a state title, but for other reasons as well. Their assistant coach, Mike Logansol, died a few weeks ago of cancer complications, and his team acted as the color guard at his funeral. When they played in the game the day of the funeral and got a victory, they gave the game ball to his daughters, and Coach Berzoza said that, you know what, our team is playing for the right reasons, and there's a lot of boys on this team that have become men through this experience.
All right, Sarah, thanks a lot. A little option look there as Schwabe gets it across midfield and into Central Catholic territory. Mike Berzawa, we see there on the sideline, the white shirt, said, when I came here to coach as an assistant in 87, my first call was to coach Loki, to coach with me. He was my mentor, my friend. He's been like a father to me as we take a look at the run. So these guys have been playing with heavy hearts. You know, Sarah mentioned that they were the color guard the day of the game, and they came out. They were up 41-0 at halftime over Chicago Christian. Mike Lokensole's number when he played semi-pro, 41. They thought that was pretty symbolic.
Yeah, that's fitting.
Second and two for the Highlanders. Here comes the blitz. Waldron had Schwabe, but he completes it anyway to Palermo at the 45 and steps out of bounds. Or did he? I thought he was out at about the 34-yard line. He stayed in, stayed on his feet, and he's down to the 21, a pickup of 27.
Great individual effort here by two players. First, by Schwabe. Look at this effort. He's just going down. He gets the ball out to Palermo. Palermo says, I'm not going to take it just for about 10 yards. I'm going to keep it my feet in bounds. Look at this. How does he stay in bounds?
I don't know.
You can't see it there. But look at him go. Here, we'll get a better look at it. Here's the great job here. Waldron coming in, gets the ball out to Palermo.
Yeah, maybe he did stay.
Yeah, the ref was right there.
Here's Franken, end around. And a one-handed tackle by David Murray, number 44. Grabbed him with one hand and brought him down with the other.
Here we are looking at the sideline. We'll check his feet. You can't tell from here. That's a tough angle.
Yep. Very close.
Great effort. Again, you play to the whistle. You don't hear it. You keep going.
It was a great run and a great effort by Schwabe. Waldron had him all wrapped up, and he still completed the pass. Second and 12. Driscoll up four with 5:15 and counting here in the third quarter. Schwabe keeps it. Boy, they haven't been able to stop that all night. Down to the 11-yard line, very close to a first down, is David Schwabe, who's very close to 200 yards rushing.
Yeah, here he is. He fakes to Palermo, comes down. Big, big hole. Nice cut. And another big gain for Schwabe.
The SCC Player of the Year, All-State, Academic All-State. And he's doing it with his legs tonight, 196 yards and a touchdown on the ground for Dave Schwabe. Third and one. Play clock at two, and they get the snap off. Schwabe to Baker, and it's incomplete. Safford was there on the coverage.
Nice throw there by Schwabe. You'll see him. They run the slant pattern to Austin Baker. He throws the ball right on the money. Baker just cannot hold on. Nice throw, catchable ball. Look at Baker, he knew it. He knew he should have had it. Driscoll's done an interesting thing. They put the two big guys, they put Palermo and Davis now in the backfield, and they put Franken in the slot as a receiver. So they're going real big now with their running backs.
Fourth and one, they're gonna go for it here from the 12. Franken has the first down and more, still on his feet inside the five and down at the three. Pickup of nine for Tim Franken, who, oh, by the way, has 135 yards.
Right.
Being overshadowed by his quarterback tonight.
Yeah, they run him in motion. Got the big guys out front. You see guys blocking. There's Davis and guys downfield, and Franken gets a nice gain. Gets him first and goal inside the five. You can just see body on body. They just execute so well. You see guys just knocking people down. They got a great offensive line. They really, really get body on body to get these yards.
Vinny Maselli and Kyle Sanders up front, both all-conference linemen. Here's Franken, and he's in for the score. Tim Franken with the touchdown. His third touchdown of the game, and it's 27-17 Driscoll pending the extra point.
We've seen that play all night, just run that play to Franken up the middle off the motion and extending their lead now to soon to be Yeah, it's in there.
That's Phil Albreski. I was close. His brother was Rick Albreski, former kicker for the Highlanders. He was a state champion. His brother gives Driscoll a 28-17 lead with just under 4 minutes to play in the third. Here's another look at the touchdown for Franken.
Vinny Maselli coming down there, getting the good block. You see Davis getting the good block, and those guys up front are opening up holes. Andrew O'Reilly, Vinny Maselli, Anthony Arena, Michael Lebedessa, and Kyle Sanders doing a nice job up there.
Curran fields it at his own eight. Coming way across the field. Running a long way to pick up about 7 yards on the return. Thanks to our friend Dave Berkson for his good work up here on the stats. 3:44 to go in the third. It's 28-17 Driscoll as they go for their seventh straight state title. They were the first program to win five. Only 13 schools nationwide have won six straight. They're trying to become the ninth nationwide to win seven straight. Waldron out across the 20 to about the 24. Be a pickup of eight.
Well, they got to keep pace, even though they're having a hard time stopping Driscoll. This offense has been able to move the ball. They've got to keep the pressure on and get points on the board to stay within a score here as they close out the third quarter. So the pressure really now falls to this offense of Bloomington Central Catholic.
Rebholz under center. Pitches to Waldron to the near side. He's tripped up as he crosses the 25-yard line. Pickup of maybe one.
It's going to be just short, bringing up third and short here. That play's been successful for them, that little pitch. And that time they read it well and came up and made a play.
Waldron with 91 yards, 14 carries for the Saints. He's dotting the I here. Rebholz takes it himself. Quarterback draw for the first down. Says, well, Schwabe can do it, I can do it too.
Yep. He's had a nice job. He's run for a few yards. Let's see, he's got, Rebholz has five. He's got a few sacks, unfortunately, but he's had a few big runs out of just scramble situations that really have helped get some first downs for Central Catholic.
He really has been more of a drop back passer, hasn't really run much. Here comes the weak side. It's Schwabe and then Davis finishing off Adam Rebholz. Steve Schwabe, the younger brother of the quarterback.
Nice job.
12.
Yeah, coming off the edge here from the outside, unblocked completely. Doesn't get him down, but really causes Rebholz to have, you see it right here from the bottom of your screen, coming in unblocked, and really does a nice job. Davis comes in to clean him up for a big, big loss, bringing up second and long.
Second and 22. Montini quarterback Tom DeCristina earlier this year said their defense came out and hit us hard. We didn't know where it was coming from. They were just right on top of us, and Rebholz can relate to that after that play, and not much this time either.
Yeah, that was a problem there between the center. He snapped the ball way too soon, and no one was ready. I think Rebholz was still looking over the defense and not sure on what he was going to do. And then here all of a sudden the ball came, and he was lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage. Now here's where you dearly do not want to make a big mistake in third and in what long, 20-some yards. Really got to be careful here. This is a really difficult situation. You almost play field position here.
Rebholz in the shotgun, trying to get a few yards back here for his punt team. One hop snap. Rebholz steps up in the pocket, throws deep across the middle, and it's picked off. It's picked off by Schwabe, and he's still on his feet at the 20, and he's gone. 45-yard interception and touchdown for Dave Schwabe, and that has been an Achilles heel for young Adam Rebholz this season. 14 interceptions on the season, and this is a big one right here.
Well, we talked about it. Here you want to just play field position. You don't want to try to get it all back and force something, and really he wasn't open and tried to hit Waldron there. And Shravi with the second interception of the game's having a career night. And just not much you can say there. Just a great play by Schwabe and extending that lead.
That's his 26th career interception. That's just too shy of the state record. Now Bresky, the extra point, 35-17 Driscoll. And when we talked earlier today about Central Catholic to have a chance in this game, we said they couldn't make mistakes. And that one cost him right there. That's a big one.
Yeah, here he is. He's looking downfield. He's got about 25 yards, so he's trying to get it all back. And he just tries to force it in there and really wasn't open. And Schwabe's playing center field back there. And as a quarterback, he reads the eyes and knows right where the ball's going and does a nice job. He's shown that he can really run the football now, both getting it from the offensive side and when he gets his hands on it from a defensive side.
And ironically, Bobby Mays says that's why he moved Rebholz from linebacker back to safety, because he wants his quarterback to play safety and read the eyes. And his counterpart, Schwabe, did it there and took it to the house for a 35-17 lead with just under a minute to go here in the third quarter.
Pretty big night for Mr. Schwabe.
Yeah. 196 yards rushing, 6 for 12, 73 yards passing.
Two interceptions.
45 yards on that touchdown run. Curran brings it out to the 25. And he stopped there, Dan Curran. Return of 14.
Curran catches the ball and they're running a return right here. Just nothing really develops and he kind of doesn't get a chance to really get going and puts them back in the hole here. Well, not too bad, 25 yard line. So just Driscoll smelling blood right now. So this is a big time right here, not to make another mistake. They just need to get some positive yards and get some first downs.
Here's Waldron. Not much there, picks up about a yard.
Waldron's coming up on 100 yards. It'd be nice to see them get Waldron the ball a little bit, maybe through the air in the flat, because he really has some good open field moves. He just has been running inside. Had some nice gains, but really hasn't a chance to break out into the open. Maybe they can get him the ball now here as we go to the fourth quarter, maybe on some screens.
We play three quarters. Driscoll is 12 minutes away from their seventh straight state championship. 35-17, the lead over Central Catholic. We'll be right back at Memorial Stadium after these messages. And we are back at Memorial Stadium. The Walgreens do what's right play.
By the referee.
How about that?
Nice.
Full service tonight. They're providing blocks. They're helping guys up off the field.
Yeah.
That would have been funny if the official would have thrown a flag on himself on that earlier run by Javier Safford on the touchdown catch. And everybody's moving. Boy, the Saints have, you know, we talked about penalties in Driscoll early, but Central Catholic has really shot themselves in the foot in the second half with penalties. And late in the first half, just jumping before the ball snapped. You don't see that so much on offense.
Yeah, they've had
done it a lot tonight,
two times in the red zone. Penalties have cost them. They ended up getting 3 points. But they may have been able to get six, but they had a penalty.
Dead ball, false start, White remains second down.
In the first half, they were down there too and had a big penalty that cost them. So right. Both sides have really struggled a little bit with penalties.
Second and 13, Rebholz out of the shotgun. Another one hopper to him, thrown behind him and almost picked off. Ricky DeVito, the 5'9 junior, was there.
Here's Rebholz trying to get the ball downfield on the curl route. Just throws a little bit behind him right into Vito's hands, and he knew it. He had 6 points, and he can't believe it. Look at him. He's still shaking his head. He wants to get in on the act, too. Schwabe's getting all the picks. He wants one.
DeVito is the guy who spelled Franken at cornerback and allowed him to really concentrate for the most part on offense. We've seen him in a defensive back a couple of times tonight, but not playing full time both ways. Third and 13. Rebholz has a man. It's Curran at the 50, and it's across midfield, and Curran is brought down at the 47-yard line. Pickup of 31, Dan Curran, the junior, with the big catch.
Curran's the wide of the trips to the left side, and he just throws it up deep, and the ball hung a little bit, but he was so wide open, the ball comes down, and he makes a nice catch, goes up and gets it. Coach Berzauer doesn't like it, but it's a nice play, and first down for Central Catholic.
Ooh, Waldron met in the backfield by a couple of Highlanders there. Trace Jenkins was the first guy to grab him, number 17.
Benny Maselli was also in on that play.
Benny Maselli had a brother on the 2005 state championship team for Driscoll. We talk about family ties on both sides here tonight. .431 yards of offense for Driscoll tonight. Second and 10. Rebholz back to throw. Oh, and a nice catch by Johnson. Who was that? The Highlanders almost got a pick there. It was Davis kind of sitting there. He fell down, and Johnson was there to pick up 21.
Yeah, here it is again. We have the same bootleg that we had a little bit earlier. And throws the ball across. I think it's Palermo. Oh, no, that was Davis. And he just didn't get a chance to kind of threw it behind Davis, and he
right.
got his feet tangled up and couldn't make the play. Here's another look at it. Just a good effort by Davis, but it's a little bit out of his reach and big play for Central Catholic.
Nice throw for Rebholz. Now he's on the quarterback draw and gets down to the 19-yard line, maybe the 18. I think they're going to mark it. Let's see where they mark it. He is down at the 19. Brings up second and three for the Saints. Down 35-17 here in the fourth. Rebholz fakes the handoff. Looking for McNeil, and it's out of bounds and incomplete.
Well covered on the play there by Schwabe and also Calabrese over there. Good pressure also from the defensive front and Rebholz. They're not quitting. They're down here again knocking from knocking on the door for some more points. So, you know, they're not going to give up.
Third and three. Rebholz will try again, deep down the middle. And a flag on the play in the end zone. Waldron was the intended receiver, and it was Schwabe there, Dave Schwabe on the coverage.
Yep, they're gonna get him for interference. It'll be first down, half the distance to the goal.
Adam Rebholz admits, I was a little shaky, wasn't quite sure what the D was doing early in the year. Now I can drop back. Line's doing a great job of giving me time. I can make my reads and go from receiver to receiver.
He's looking down the middle here. He wants to get Waldron across the middle. You see Schwabe just bumps Waldron before the ball
Pass
gets there.
Interference.
It's
defense,
a good call.
Half the distance to the goal line. Automatic first down.
Highlander fans say boo. They thought he was going for the ball and then got there on time. It's first down and goal for the Saints. Waldron right up the middle, in for the touchdown. Ryan Waldron, the 10-yard touchdown run. And the Saints say, we're not finished quite yet.
Good explosion there. You can see how he hits the line of scrimmage going full speed, like a streak, and just a nice explosive run. For 6 points for Waldron. 24 touchdowns rushing on the year. Over 1,800 yards. He's on the day. He's got over 100 today.
Michael Finger on for the point after. It's good, and it's 35-24. The Saints pull within 11 with 9:51 to play in this 4A state championship game. Driscoll going for 7 in a row. Here's our Illinois Army National Guard defensive play of the game. Dial 1-800-GO-ARMY. And it's David Schwabe, who's over 300 yards all-purpose in this ball game, including this 40-yard touchdown return, 45-yard interception. Central Catholic showing onside kick. Oh, and he kicks it backwards.
It was interesting. They were offside, so it wouldn't have mattered. But
Michael Finger gets negative yardage on that one.
Good idea, poor execution.
That happens sometimes on a punt, but you rarely see it on a kickoff.
Yeah. I don't know what they're going to call this now.
I don't know how they get it to bounce up like that anyway. That's got to be a tough play. And I'm surprised we didn't see that from Driscoll tonight. They like to do that after they score. They like to, they like to score and do that onside kick and really, get you on your heels.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
They appear to have come to a consensus.
Dead ball, encroachment, white. Reset the clock to 9:51.
Okay, what happened there is as soon as you're offsides, it's automatic dead ball. So whatever happens in the play, you can't carry it on. So no matter where the ball ends up, you're going to bring it back and re-kick. So it's actually a break for Central Catholic, because now they got another chance. If they want to onside it, they get another chance at it, or now they can kick it deep.
So Michael Finger's record has been expunged.
Yeah, that's right. And I think after that, And after that, they probably won't try that style of onside kick again. Yeah, they're going deep.
You know he's going to take some heat in the film session for that one. Here's Davis picking it up at his own 35 and brought down at the 44-yard line, where the Highlanders will take over after a return of 10. 35-24 Driscoll. Let's go downstairs to Sarah Kustak.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with Joy Allen, the principal of Bloomington Central Catholic. And I was just talking to you about this. This is an incredible crowd that you have out here today.
This is wonderful. The Saints are great supporters. Always have been.
And you said that there's some special notes up at the school for these guys?
Yes, the feeder schools, the Catholic Elementary feeder schools, sent cards of congratulations and good luck for this game. So those are hung all throughout the cafeteria.
And do these kids know any of the guys on the team?
Yes, some of the guys on the team go over and read to the kids during school time, and they'll read, take different books and read to them and go see them. And we take balloons over to them for all of their different athletic events also. So we support each other.
Thanks, Joy. Well, a lot of fans in the stands, and I'm sure a lot of fans out in Bloomington watching these boys tonight.
Go Saints!
Back up to you guys.
All right, Sarah, thanks a lot. We had not been out to their new facility. Central Catholic built a new school, and Bill Hunman Memorial Field. It's a beautiful, beautiful facility. The school is amazing, and they used to be in downtown Bloomington. Their basketball court was known as the Pit. Which was kind of a nice way of saying it, I think, but it was legendary, as that one goes for no gain for Driscoll. But they've got beautiful facilities, do the Central Catholic Saints. And there's a look at the third quarter stats. Central Catholic has scored since then.
Yeah, it's the rush yardage there is big, 358 yards rushing, 200 of those being Dave Schwabe. And the passing yards, Repholz has kept them in the game with his arm, 13 of 21 for 191 yards. Turnovers pretty much even, except for the big interception return that kind of really changed the outcome of the game. But right here now, you've got a potential stop right here to get back in the game.
Stats update brought to you by Menards. Save big money at Menards, 3rd and 6. Schwabe has an option if he wants it. He keeps it himself, still on his feet, and Central Catholic didn't wrap him up, and he's got a first down. The Saints have been unable to tackle at times, and that's allowed Driscoll to keep drives alive.
The individual effort here of David Schwabe, they're in position to make tackles, and he breaks through. He was would have been short there if right. they would have those two guys would have tackled them, and he ends up falling forward for three or four more yards to get the first down. Just great individual effort by David Schwabe. He's been making plays all night, and that's why they're in the lead 35-24.
His coach says he's a student of the game and a pure leader. He has shown that here tonight. Over 200 yards rushing now for Schwabe. First and 10. Gives to Palermo inside. Oh, that guy can run over people, can he? Kevin Palermo, 6'3", 225, Bulls ahead. Brought down at the 33-yard line.
Yeah, here's just a good look at Palermo, the big guy. He comes in here, just runs through tackles, puts his head down, keeps bowling forward. He's done that a couple of times. It looks like a run we've seen earlier in the game. They're just pounding now with Palermo, Schwabe, and sometimes Davis. Just three big boys carrying the load for Driscoll.
They don't really have to be too creative here either. Second and one. Time winding down as we approach the 7-minute mark. Here's Franken. Still on his feet, keeps it alive. First down, Driscoll at the Central Catholic 28-yard line.
They just have so many different weapons, and you know, we haven't heard much from Franken. He's probably only had, let's see, maybe four carries the second half, and he's the quick, you know, agile runner. And then they've got Palermo and Davis, and haven't even heard much from Calabrese and some of their others.
Synchronizing their wristbands.
Yep.
And that's one thing Bobby Mays told us earlier this week was last year he felt like they had a good quarterback, good running back. Now they've got so many weapons this year. When you look at Calabrese, Schwabe, Frank, and Palermo, Austin Baker, the 6'6 receiver. Here's Schwabe back to throw, looking for Christie. Has him at the 5-yard line. Curran was there on the coverage, but it'll be first down and goal for the Highlanders.
They get one-on-one coverage out there with Christie. Get a nice view here of just the way that Schwabe can deliver the football right on the money. Nice execution. Nice to step and throw. And Mr. Christie bobbled a little bit, but he held on for the catch.
Travis Christie is Driscoll's possession receiver. Mike Berzawa says he runs the best routes on the team. And a good one there. First and goal for the Highlanders. Davis is the man in motion. Schwabe keeps it himself. Murray in pursuit. And he still gets back to the line of scrimmage. Flag on the play. Mike Berzawa, the Bears coach of the week earlier this year. $1,500 to the Driscoll Catholic program. He'll have a chalk talk with Lovie Smith next week. Be honored before the Bears game on December 2nd.
Nice honor for coach.
Lovie or Berzawa? You see what I did there.
There you go.
6 minutes to go in this one. Bobby Mays on the other sideline.
Had a face mask penalty there, half the distance to the goal. Now first and goal.
We kind of chuckled.
From the third.
Incidental face mask, white, half the distance to the goal line. Replay first down.
It's like your kids coming to you and say, I didn't mean to. Yeah. We both kind of chuckled at Bobby Mays at halftime when he talked to Sarah and said, you know, how do you stop this offense of Driscoll? And like, well, I'm not sure, you know.
Right. And nobody has found the answer to that.
Montini came close. Held him to one touchdown and a couple of field goals in week 9.
Well, Montini was a real good football team this year, too, and we really favored the win their conference.
Here's Franken. He's in for the score, virtually untouched. His fourth touchdown of the game. I believe that ties a record.
That actually beats a record. There it goes, Mr. Franken in for his fourth score.
What class were you?
Class 4. This is it. This was it.
This was it.
Yep. Just broke it. So you've been
I thought you had 4.
No, I had 3.
Oh. Well, there goes another record.
Yeah,
huh,
you've been here for a bunch of them that were broken.
Phil Albreski.
Got it blocked.
That one blocked. And that turned the game around for Central Catholic last week against Mount Carmel. They blocked the extra point with under 2 minutes to play, came back and scored and won the game. That block probably won't make much difference in this one. 5:34 left. It's Driscoll Catholic, 5.5 minutes away from their seventh straight state title. Back at Memorial Stadium, Lee Hall and Greg Bradshaw, the former Woodstock quarterback, has his name erased from the record books yet again. You are one of six players to have three touchdowns in the title game rushing, and Tim Franken of Driscoll Catholic now with four. So, sorry, my friend.
Yeah, well, Frank is a little better athlete than I was. Mine were all quarterback sneaks.
Here's Javier Safford running out of room. We haven't heard a lot from him. He had a big first half, has seven receptions for 107 yards and two touchdowns, but the Highlanders have been paying a little bit more attention to him this half.
Yeah, I talked about it at halftime with you, Lee, off the air, that Safford had a big half, and I'd be surprised if Driscoll really would allow Safford to beat them in the second half, and I don't think he has a catch here in the second half.
He had seven catches in last week's game for 99 yards, including three on that game-winning drive. He really came up big, and Rebholz did too on that drive. As Waldron gets the carry here, out to the 20, pickup of seven. Rebholz really showed me a lot of moxie last week, Greg. He misfired on his first pass on that final drive with under a couple minutes to go, and then if you don't count the intention, the grounding to stop the clock, he completed his next six pass attempts and got his team into the end zone to get him to the state championship game against a very good Mount Carmel team last week.
He's played well here today, too, actually, and just made a couple of big mistakes, but you're going to make some mistakes against a good Driscoll team. But he's played very, very well, almost 200 yards passing today, and he's been a good effort and just meeting up against a pretty good defensive football team.
Two touchdowns, two interceptions for Rebholz, but we agree that the one that Schwabe picked off and took back for the touchdown was probably the thing that changed the momentum of this game. After they kicked that field goal, Central Catholic had, and again, the Saints jump.
Yeah, that's probably five or six of those on the game. For the game, they've got nine penalties for 94 yards, and I think at least five of those have been at least legal motion penalties.
Dead ball, false start, White, still third down.
You can kind of understand it when a lineman does it. When receivers are doing it, that's kind of unacceptable, I think.
Well, it's pretty much unacceptable for Coach Mays if anybody's
yeah,
doing
well,
it.
Well, that's true. That's true. Rebholz back to throw, looking for McNeil. It's tipped at the line of scrimmage and incomplete.
Campanella got his big hand up there. 6'4", 227-pound defensive end. Did a nice job getting his hand up in there. Going to force Bloomington Central Catholic to punt the ball away.
.413 to go in this fourth quarter of the 4A state championship game. Galena, Dakota, and Plano are your champions 1 through 3A, respectively. And it looks like Driscoll Catholic will be your 4A champ. Safford. High booming punt, fair catch called for by Calabrese, and he fields it. It is at the Central Catholic 42-yard line. Chevy Drive of the Game is brought to you by Chevrolet. See what's new at ChevyDrivesChicago.com. And here's Mr. Franken.
Yeah, just showing his quickness, little twinkle toes action here. He won't quit. Oh, no, that's the one later in the game. That was second half, and a real simple three-yard gain behind the good blocking up front. Nice block by Vinny Maselli on that play. And Tim Franken gets in his fourth score. He has four scores on the day, setting a new 4A state championship game record for most rushing touchdowns in a game.
Driscoll now averaging 39 points a game in their seven state championship games in a row here, and only allowing 15 on an average. And here's a big run from P.J. Fajardo, the senior, who we haven't called his name, and a flag on the play. That's his first carry of the night. And it's coming back.
Yeah, nice runs. Going to be brought back. Just nice to get some other guys in the game here. Get some experience. You know, Driscoll seems like they're coming here every year, so get some of these guys in here to get ready for next year,
right.
You know.
Well, and that's one of the things that one of the past players, Victor Arliss, I believe, said about the program. You know, they get the 5 extra weeks of practice every year.
Right.
I mean, that's like having spring football in college.
Walking the back against Black.
That only helps Mark you.
From the spot of the foul. Replay first down.
Yeah, you could put those. Here's the replay here. A nice run. You'll see right here on the outside, they call the hold right there. They call the block on the back, actually, and just nullifies that nice game. But you're right, you know, 5 weeks. You know, they're in the playoffs. You know, we're looking at some of the other schools 10 times in a row. And when you go to a state championship seven times in a row, that's 35 extra weeks of practice over that time. You know, that's a lot of extra work for some of your younger guys.
Here
goes Schwabe again.
He's still on his feet at the 30. And out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Schwabe still running strong here in the fourth, 27 yards on the pickup.
Fortune looks like this one's going to come back too, but here again, just showing his athletic ability. Nice block there on the corner by number 12, Nick Nitti. And right here at the end, though, they call a penalty. It looks like another either block in the back or hold.
It's been a fun game, a competitive game, but a really sloppy game when it comes to penalties. Nine on the Saints, and I believe this is the ninth on Driscoll.
Well, it looks like they're going to call this
one. Or is it on Central Catholic?
It looks like it's on Central Catholic.
So it'll be the 10th on the Saints.
Personal foul, face mask, white, half the distance to the goal line, first down.
All right, let's take another look.
Oh, there it is. Schwabe's out there blocking, and
McNeil.
Looks like McNeil just grabbed him by the face mask and got twisted it down. 15-yard face mask penalty. Just can't do that.
So it's first and 10 for the Highlanders from the 13. Franken, the 5, in for the score. Franken, his 5th. Touchdown of the evening, a 13-yard score for Tim Franken, gives him 159 yards and 5 touchdowns in this ball game.
There's the kickout block by Vinny Maselli again. He cuts up inside and walks in the end zone basically untouched. Steve Schwabe coming through in motion to kick a nice block in there as well. Just good execution and nice play.
And that makes it 48-24 Driscoll with 3:27 to play here in the 4A title game.
Well, we talked about one of the things that was going to happen during this game was because Bloomington Central Catholic has 9 guys going both ways, we thought that could be a factor. Driscoll may wear them down, and really about midway through the third quarter, this game started to turn. That pivotal interception by Schwabe in return for a touchdown started that, and then just the snowball started rolling, and just very, very difficult, you know, to come back against a team like Driscoll. They just keep coming at you. With all the weapons that they have, they had a lot of pounding. You know, Davis to start running from the backfield position, along with Palermo, and they started pounding those guys. And certainly Franken's had a great second half, 3 touchdowns.
We are told that the 48 points by Driscoll in a 4A title game equals a state record by Joliet Catholic in 1999.
Dan Curran there just struggled a little bit on the kickoff return, but held on to the ball, and they're going to have a put some of their other guys in. It looks like they're bringing the first unit out again for BCC.
48-24, 3:21 to play here in the fourth. Driscoll will become the ninth team nationally to win seven straight state championships. Ryan Waldron's not through. He's out to the 43-yard line.
Here comes both second units come in. There goes Ryan Waldron, had a great career, great year this year.
Nothing to hang his head about, although you probably wouldn't be able to convince him of that right now. Franken has 30 points. That's the most points for an individual in a Class 4A title game, breaking the record of former Highlander Greg Turner, set back in 2003. And he has the most touchdowns for an individual in a title game.
Number 10, Taylor Jewett, in the game at quarterback. Nice run there. He's 5'7", 150-pound sophomore.
So time running out. Central Catholic will get some youngsters out there, and it's Taylor Jewett, sophomore quarterback, on the keeper of that time for the Saints. Tim Burzawa was asked about the great track record. The fact we won a lot of games in a row is just a tribute to number one. I think Driscoll High School's values, the faith, everything the boys are brought up to believe. That's a very big part of who we are and how we carry ourselves. Carry that time by Robbie Seidel. And there's a look at Driscoll's championship march. 2001, one of the best games, probably the best title game in this run, without a doubt. Mount Carmel, Luke Drone, who went on to play at Illinois State as quarterback. That went to double overtime, I believe. They shut out Mount Carmel the next year. They beat Prairie Central. And you saw the rest of the string there as we come back to live action. It's Seidel again. He's a sophomore.
Yeah, here's Brazil. Here comes the Gatorade coming in. He has no clue. He's definitely not prepared. And he gets nailed in the back. Bullseye right there.
That's refreshing on a night like tonight, I'm
sure.
Yeah,
it is. Probably was made him feel a little warmer. It's already cold. That was couldn't have been much colder than it already is.
And that's Brendan Quinn, another sophomore for Bobby Mays Saints. Brzawa gives credit to the coaching staff, senior leaders. Comes down to all those factors working together. The obvious thing, all our kids care about each other. And you have to be impressed by what they've been able to do at Driscoll Catholic. You talk about the great powers in football in high school in Illinois, the Mount Carmels, New Lenox Providence, Joliet Catholic. This is the only team in the state to have won five straight, and they're going to win their seventh straight here tonight.
Yeah, certainly they deserve a lot of credit, this whole program and the kids. They all work hard, and they do it with class. And just very, very impressive, and just seem to reload over there. You know, there's no rebuilding, it's just reloading, and they just have guys that fill spots. You know, Schwabe's a great example of that. You know, not a played quarterback, and he comes in, and, you know, he's as good as we've seen. I know Petey was a great quarterback. They've had some good ones, but Schwabe's as good as anything we've seen.
And the keeper for Jewett. He's out at the 23-yard line. They'll say he's down in bounds, and the clock will keep winding. And it's Driscoll Catholic winning their unprecedented in the state of Illinois, seventh straight. State title 48-24, the final tonight as they defeat the Saints of Bloomington Central Catholic, who finish 13-1. The Highlanders a perfect 14-0. .526 total yards tonight for the Highlanders. That's you don't have to say much more than that.
Yeah, their offense really carried them tonight. You know, on the other side of the ball, Bloomington Central Catholic, 363 yards of offense. They really moved the ball well.
They did.
Just could not stop this high-powered offense of Driscoll. But really, you know, it was a football game. Driscoll was in a football game till really the middle of that third quarter. That big, you know, turning point in the game was that interception returned by Schwabe that really kind of extended the lead for Driscoll. And then they really, as they always do, they take advantage, they start smelling blood and started wearing them down and really put the game out of reach there at the end of the third quarter.
7-7 after one. It was 21-14 at the half. Central Catholic only managed that field goal in the third quarter, and it's a 48-24 win for Driscoll. Let's go downstairs to Sarah Kustak and Mike Brzawa.
Thanks, guys. Coach, I don't even know where to begin. I'm going to ask you for a turning point in the game, but so many incredible plays by your seniors and by your players tonight. What are your thoughts on the game?
You know what? Our boys, we had one of the smallest teams we've ever had, but they're resilient. They've got hearts of gold. Everything you saw we had to overcome tonight, they've had to do that all year. And it's, you know, to win the first one and the second, you know, it's tough. But when to win, to continue to win, when you're everybody's Super Bowl, week in and week out, you know, that's satisfying. And I'm so proud of them. I'm so lucky to have everybody and my family here to support me. But you know what? I've been blessed to have a great coaching staff and that's been here, wonderful kids. And you know what? I think it all starts with Driscoll Catholic. And it starts with the values that they're taught and our faith and belief in God. And I'm blessed to be a part of this.
Unprecedented seven straight in a row in the state of Illinois. But you told me earlier this week that this was a new year. What does this year's title mean to you?
You know, this one's special because we've had the kids always ask, you know, who's the best out of all the teams? And I got to tell them, you got to look at the 14-0 teams. And then what this team has done this year and the scores, we've put on clinics in all playoff games. And it's a credit to them. Great senior leadership, and I don't know what else to say.
Coach, there's a lot of people that want your time. Thank you for and congratulations on tonight's game.
Thank you very much.
Lee, back up to you guys.
All right, Sarah, thanks a lot. You know, David Schwabe, the star of this game, said we didn't win 34 football games. Everybody else won 34, that 34 straight playoff wins. We've won four so far, looking to win our fifth, and they did it tonight in convincing fashion, 48-24 to win their seventh straight state championship. Back after this.
Seven in a row for Driscoll Catholic. Bloomington Central Catholic raising that second-place trophy. It's the second time in their school's history they have finished second, three-time state champs. But tonight, it belonged to the Driscoll Highlanders, 48-24. And out of these seven straight championships that Driscoll has won, this 48-point total, the highest that they have ever scored in a state championship ball game. We welcome you back to Memorial Stadium here in the campus of the University of Illinois as the Saints from Bloomington Central Catholic hung tough early on, but then Driscoll just too much. Dave Bernhardt back with you along with Jason Kirby and Scott Hamilton. And you guys have been warriors all day. You've gone down on the field in this cold weather. What are your thoughts when you're right down there, right along the sidelines looking at this Driscoll team?
I was really impressed. Best Driscoll team I've seen. I've seen some of them up close. I thought that this team had as many athletes and was as well prepared and as defensively as solid as any of the others.
Yeah, I was very impressed with the quarterback and the running back combination. Two running backs and quarterbacks that when they got out in the opening used their blockers, had the feel for where to go, and had the quickness and the strength to go ahead and get there too. I was very impressed with their effort.
You see the Highlanders right there receiving their trophy, their medals. They win seven in a row. And these young men know nothing but winning state championships. You know, you go back 7 years, and I think that's what the impressive part is. How old were these people 7 years ago? And that's when the first state title was won, and here comes championship number seven in a row, eight overall for Driscoll. And as Lee has mentioned a couple of times tonight, only nine schools in this country, have won seven consecutive state football championships, and you're looking at one of them right there. And again, now the groundwork is laid for all the people that come in the future to match this. And I don't know, this one was awfully impressive. Bloomington Central Catholic, one of the top teams that have come in to face them in a title game.
Yeah, I was very impressed with Bloomington Central Catholic. I thought that they had a number of good athletes, and I thought that they were very well prepared. They were in this game, I thought, up in the second half and presented a challenge, definitely.
But you made a great comment right before the half, before we sent it to the third quarter. You said, you know, no real pressure on them. Driscoll just goes out and takes care of business. Nothing rattled them.
They were a machine.
Yeah, looking at some records, Driscoll had nine records tonight.
Wow.
Setting the championship game. 30 points by Franken, five touchdowns by Franken, both records. 238 yards, most rushing yards by Schwabe. Five individual rushing touchdowns. Tied points by a team with 48. Most yards on the offensive side, 526. Most yards by both teams, 889. And then Driscoll had 430 rushing yards, and teams combined for 602 yards. So, you know, early on we thought maybe we weren't going to have much offense, but, boy, we sure had some in the last game.
Boy, they lit it up. And I'm sorry, Jason, I did steal your line. Let me set you up again. What'd you think of Driscoll Catholic tonight?
Same as last year. Wow.
Okay, great. Here's our Menards final stats update for you. Save big money at Menards, and there's many of the numbers you just heard Scott run through, and the numbers he ran through are all records that were set tonight here in this 4A state championship ball game. We've talked about all day today, time of possession, and look right here, it's meaningless, right? Central Catholic had it for seven or six more minutes more than Driscoll.
Yeah, and the thing that comes out big here is, well, third down conversions weren't as big in this game, but how many third down conversions did Driscoll need? But what comes back in the end is Schwabe had 243 yards rushing, 7 for 13 passing, everything. He was a phenomenal player tonight.
And you throw in the interception return, the 45-yard interception return, and he had over 300 yards in all-purpose yardage. Great effort by Dave Schwabe, who, remarkably enough, August 9th, a very key date in Driscoll history this year, August 9th was the first time that David Schwabe took a snap from center. He was not going to be the quarterback coming into this season.
Yeah, you know, I thought that on the BCC side, I thought you got to give a lot of credit to Javier Safford. He came out, seven receptions, 107 yards, two touchdowns, really played well and tried to keep him in the game and do what he could. Rebels did a nice job doing some things. And I thought BCC was able to hang in there and play awfully well and just kind of ran out of gas late third, fourth quarter.
A lot of highlights tonight. Let's take a look at our Honda game highlights. Honda featuring the all-new 268-horsepower Accord V6. We get things rolling with Driscoll and who else but Tim Franken, one of his five touchdowns here tonight. This on a three-yard touchdown run to make it 28-17. That's after Central Catholic to close to 21-17. And here's Schwabe on the defensive end. This will be his 26th career interception. Picks it off at the 45-yard line, slips one tackle, and then he has that knack for finding the lane. He will take this one all the way. 41 seconds left in the third quarter. This is the one that really opened it up. 35-17 Highlanders. Then Ryan Waldron closed out his career at Central Catholic, a 9-yard touchdown run at the 9:51 mark of the fourth quarter. Cut the margin to 35-24, and you're waiting for that one turnover, the momentum changer, but the momentum changer was all about Tim Franken. 3-yard touchdown run with 5:34 to play to make it a 41-24 game, and then touchdown number five, state record touchdown number five in a 4A championship game. This one on a 13-yard run, 48-24, 48 points tying the 1999 record of Joliet Catholic Academy for most points in a 4A state championship ball game. So you have your champions here today. All four games, we don't call them blowouts, but they were wide margins, and I don't know that we walked in here tonight and expected to be able to say that to you with all the wide numbers, big numbers we've had offensively.
Well, without a doubt, the first three games, In the second half, it got a little bit quiet as far as watching games in terms of competition level. I really thought the third quarter of this particular game and into the fourth quarter, there was still quite a bit of competition going on. Driscoll did just pull away in the end.
Let's take a look at those scoring highlights brought to you by Sports Authority. Sports Authority, dedicated to the dedicated. Here are many of the plays you just saw moments ago. The field goal opened it up for Central Catholic. Unable to get that touchdown to start that third quarter. And then Driscoll takes over, scoring a couple of touchdowns sandwiched around a Waldron 9-yard touchdown run. And then Franken, all he knew tonight was the end zone. And with that, Central Catholic is able to raise that trophy above their heads one more time. So another big night again for the Highlanders. And let's go downstairs and talk to Sarah Kustak. Sarah?
Dave, I am with our Country Insurance player of the game, Tim Franken. Tim, 5 touchdowns in today's game. What was working so well for you out there?
Well, obviously the offensive line did a great job, so I have to give them credit in the world. We were able to do a lot of things offensively, so that opened up the running game as well. And it was actually Coach Buzz's record before, so I give him I thank him for giving me the ball inside the goal line and letting me break the record.
He didn't have too much of an ego. He let you go ahead and take it.
Right.
Also, I talked earlier in this game, but you guys playing for a state title, but also playing for something a little bit more. Your former assistant coach, who had passed away this couple of weeks, can you just tell me a little bit about Coach Lokensol and what he meant to you guys?
Coach Lokensol is a great man. He loved the players, from like starters, even the kids that didn't play so much. He loved the game, and we wanted to dedicate the rest of the season to him and show how much he meant to us. So.
And Tim, just tell me, walking out of here in a Driscoll uniform with 3 state titles, what does that feel like to you tonight?
It's a great feeling. You know, this one was an important one, though. I wanted to get the one in my senior year, and it feels really good.
How is this year different than all the rest?
Well, it's just I know that I'm not going to be able to experience it again, so I cherish every moment, and it's great to come out like this.
Sounds good, Tim. Congratulations. Great game, and go have some fun with your teammates.
Thank you.
Back up to you guys.
Thank you very much, Sarah, as we wrap up day one coverage here on a Friday. It is just 4 games out of 8. We have 4 more games coming your way tomorrow. 12 hours of football tomorrow starting at 10 o'clock. Metamora takes on Morris in 5A. Then Joliet Catholic Academy. A lot of folks are anxious to see the Hilltoppers. They are gunning for their 13th state championship. They'll take on Lamont the first time the Indians have been here. Then in Class 7A, Wheaton-Warrenville South will look to defend a state championship. They won it in 8A last year. They'll take on the Lake Zurich Bears. That will be our 4 o'clock game. And then our championship ball game, Naperville North, with 1 loss in a year, will take on Glenbard North. Glenbard North, the Panthers, will come into tomorrow night's championship ball game. 4 losses on the season. Be the first time ever a state championship game has featured a team with 4 losses. So, great ball games coming your way tomorrow. It's been great working with you guys here tonight, all day, actually. It seems like we've been here almost 2 days, but it's been great. Thanks for spending time with us.
It's a blast.
Yeah, enjoyed a great day of football, and congratulations to not only the state champions, but also the runners-up.
Indeed. Galena 35-7 over Tuscola in 1A. Dakota 50-12 over Westville in 2A. Plano defeated Columbia 32-7 in 3A. And then Driscoll 48-24 over Bloomington Central Catholic here in Class 4A. So make sure, we'll give you about 12 hours to take a break here, but then come on back. IHSA TV Network will be right back at you at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. It will be Metamora taking on Morris. That will get our day started. We hope to see you then. For Scott Hamilton, Jason Kirby, I'm Dave Bernhardt. Thanks for joining us, everybody. We'll talk to you tomorrow at 10.